What's up, guys? Welcome back to another brand new What If series. This is a scenario I wanted to do for quite a while, as you could probably tell since I kept posting about it on my channel, and it's one that it seems like a lot of people wanted to actually see. We all know that Chi-Chi was originally a fighter before being a housewife, and I feel that Z and Super kinda just wasted her and ruined her character by just making her that when she could have been so much more. So for this scenario, we're going to look at a timeline where Chi-Chi continues fighting, and we're going to see what happens if she were actually a Z fighter. To start off, all of Dragon Ball, of course, will remain the same, up until when Goku and Chi-Chi actually get married. During this time, she never actually stops fighting, and because Goku is there, naturally they would train together a lot, since they just spend a lot of their time together, that's where they were for most of that time. The two of them continue doing this for a while until Chi-Chi ends up getting pregnant, because obviously she can't keep training if she's pregnant. And of course, that leads to Gohan getting born like normal. And then Chi-Chi slowly eases herself back into training because she now has to care for Gohan, so she's not constantly training like Goku, but the fact that she's training at all, even if it's just a little, it's a lot better than her not doing anything. Gohan ends up not being raised completely the same as he was before. Of course, Chi-Chi still wants him to study and become a scholar, but she's a lot more lenient. It's kind of like how she is with Goten, where she's more open to giving him some freedom and allowing him to train from time to time. He's not going to be training a lot right now though, since he's below 4 years old at this point. However, the big difference here is that he has a big motivation to train later on, because he's growing up in a family that revolves around martial arts, and he looks up to his parents and wants to be like them in the future, and eventually he wants to be strong, especially like Goku. Eventually, Goku and friends plan a meeting at Kame House, since it's been a while since they've seen each other, and this time Chi-Chi actually comes along, since she's not stuck in the house this time. The three of them all arrive to the island, much to everyone's surprise as they see Goku, of all people, has a son now, and he seems pretty smart. That's weird. As for power levels at this time, there's actually a decent change here. Gohan, for one, his normal power level jumps from 1 to 10. Not that high, but he's 4 years old, and he's had a little bit of experience from some very light training, so the fact that he's that high at all is amazing. Chi-Chi, instead of her last recorded power of 130, is now at a much larger 270, over double of what it was before. Goku also saw a large increase, not as much as Chi-Chi, but still, from 334 to 430 with his weighted clothes. And since taking off his weighted clothes gives him about a 25% increase in power, as we saw from the Raditz saga, that puts him at a whopping 538 when he's using all of his power. He has a lot more time to train, and instead of training alone in seclusion with his wife, she's actually his training partner, so he has someone to train with, so they've both seen a large increase in power, and this will be very helpful for what's about to come, and you all know what I'm getting into. Of course, Raditz comes now, and we have a very different encounter here from what we had before. Seeing Goku's family, Raditz is pretty disappointed in his brother. He has a family now? This isn't something a Saiyan would do. Kakarot, you've gone soft! Raditz shouts this at his brother, given that he's kind of disappointed to see that Goku's living like this. And at this point, we actually see a huge change that causes a big turn in the arc. Since Chi-Chi is there, well, being how she is, she thinks it's a good idea to scold Raditz, much to Goku protesting because he knows this won't end well. And it doesn't. Raditz simply laughs at this and proceeds to slap her out of the way. And yeah, that's a pretty big mistake. His scouter then alerts him of a huge increase in power, coming from his brother. Goku's power shoots up way past that 538 that I mentioned before, because he has a huge rage boost now, capping him off at a massive power of nearly 900. If this same scenario in Battle of Gods allowed Vegeta to match up against Beerus briefly, then the same would happen here with Goku versus Raditz. We even saw this in the future Trunks arc of Dragon Ball Super when Goku found out Zamasu killed Chi-Chi and Goten, and he didn't even witness that, nor were they even his timeline's version of them, but he was still really angry about it, and it gave him a temporary boost in power that allowed him to match up against the two. This time, he's actually seeing someone hurt his wife in front of him, and this causes him to explode. Raditz, of course, still has a much higher power, but this sudden spike and blitz from Goku catches him off guard, and his power continues rising. Witnessing the intruder threaten him, then proceed to hit his wife, send him into a blind rage, and Raditz is now paying the price. His power keeps rising, it passes 900, 920, 940, and Raditz is getting concerned. With each hit he lands, Goku gets more fired up and angered towards his brother. Even with the power difference, Goku's rage, combined with his skill in martial arts, let him keep up, eventually delivering a powerful gut punch that is basically like what Gohan did when he headbutted Raditz. Raditz, now heavily angered and frustrated, regains his composure and delivers his own powerful hit back to Goku, which knocks him to the ground as Raditz charges up an energy beam to finish off his brother.
That was impressive, Kakarot, but your little outburst won't be enough to defeat—
Raditz is cut off mid-sentence as he's headbutted with such a force that he's knocked far back into the ocean. Gohan, who had been watching this also, had a rage boost similar to his father and similar to what he had in the original timeline against Raditz, with his power level rising upwards of 1200. Raditz, who was already weakened by the fight with Goku, and now hit with a powerful blow from Gohan in his head, is now floating unconscious in the ocean near Kame House, with Gohan unconscious as well from his side of the attack. I mean, that was pretty painful for him too, knocking his head into someone else's head. Krillin and Bulma help Chi-Chi up and then Goku as they check to make sure Gohan is okay, which he is, but out of nowhere, they sense another power, Piccolo. He had been watching this whole time and wanted to intervene but was kind of impressed with what Goku was showing. Despite the fact that the Saiyan was so much more powerful than them, Goku was still able to defeat him with the help of Gohan. Now that he's unconscious, Piccolo advises them to kill Raditz while he's out cold, but Goku protests this idea since it's fighting dirty and, Goku being Goku, he likes giving second chances to people and doesn't want to kill an enemy right away. Not to mention, he does want to get some info out of him, and, I mean, the fact that he's his brother makes him kind of hesitant. Especially because of that, he wants to give him a second chance. And in all fairness, they don't really trust Piccolo either, and they don't want to do what he says. And even if Piccolo did try to pull something, he's way outclassed here, given that Goku is much more powerful. And although they're weaker, Chi-Chi and Krillin are there as well and could collectively overpower him. Piccolo actually agrees with this since he does want to get info out of this guy, since he seems to know a lot. And while he doesn't want to work with Goku, he thinks that Raditz may be working with more people if he was somehow able to get the resources to get a ship and that piece of technology he was wearing and able to get to Earth somehow. And if there's more people like him, that's a problem for Piccolo because, like he said, he wants to be the one to take over Earth, not some intruders. They pull Raditz out of the water, and he's pretty beaten up, but they don't really know what to do with this guy, which makes them nervous. Now when they think about it again, even though he's heavily weakened and out cold, once he's awake he'll be a loose cannon, but Goku, Chi-Chi, Piccolo, and Krillin combined actually have enough power to overwhelm him, and at least to match him in strength if anything. But still, everyone is having second thoughts about doing this, given that he could just wake up any minute and attack them, with Piccolo really itching to kill him. They also notice that thing he was wearing on his face, which is the Scouter. It has completely exploded from the impact with Gohan, with Bulma trying to gather what's left of it to study it. Obviously they don't know that there's a microphone recording what's happening, but with the Scouter destroyed there's no microphone, so Vegeta, Nappa, and whoever else aren't able to hear what's going on. If they're not gonna kill him, they at least want to restrain him. While they have Roshi and he could use the evil containment wave, which would work, they would still actually have to release him from the seal to actually talk to him. So while it might actually keep him in captivity, it won't really work if they want to get info out of him. Goku remembers that if Raditz is just like him, his tail is a weak spot, and they can either grab it or clamp it down somehow to effectively paralyze him and keep him in check. And at this point, they don't really have any other options, and given that fact, as goofy as it sounds, they end up doing that because they don't really see any other way, and Goku really does not want to kill him, and they'd rather just do this. As opposed to the evil containment wave, this is a much easier way of getting info out of him. With Piccolo and Chi-Chi holding his tail down, Raditz feels an immense jolt of pain, and begins to regain his consciousness before the group begins to interrogate him. And he's pretty much stuck there because his tail is being held by two people. He's of course really angered by this, but he can't do anything because not only is he tied up, he's being held down by his tail, so even if he wanted to move, he wouldn't be able to just because of the immense pain he's feeling from this. Not to mention, Goku and Krillin are there, as well as Piccolo and Chi-Chi who can fight, so if he does somehow escape, they will try to attack him, so he knows not to make any dumb moves. Here they actually begin to interrogate him. Since their conversation was cut short before by Raditz slapping Chi-Chi, they find out why he's actually here. They already know he's Goku's brother, and that he's part of a race called Saiyans, but they figure out he was here for Goku so he can get another Saiyan to join him. That technology he was wearing was a Scouter, which sensed power levels and could record what was happening. But now that it's destroyed, Raditz is off the radar, but that also means that it would alert the other Saiyans that something went wrong, and Raditz tells them that even if he's killed, Vegeta and Nappa would come there in years' time in order to enact their revenge. Through more interrogation and talking, they're able to find out about the Saiyans and Frieza. As they find out the motivation of the group of Saiyans, why there's just a small amount of them, and who Frieza is and what they're trying to accomplish. The mention of Frieza here is actually enough to concern the group, because while Raditz is their enemy and is kind of aggressive, this Frieza guy sounds much worse, and in fact it might just be a common enemy for Raditz and the group, even if they don't know it yet. During the interrogation, Raditz begins telling them all about the other two Saiyans, Nappa and Vegeta. They're able to learn from him that they're more powerful than Raditz, and how Raditz was kind of the weakling of the group. Goku is able to sense that by saying this, Raditz isn't exactly accepted by the other Saiyans, and he refers to himself as a weakling because of this. After getting info from Raditz, the group decides that they know enough, and they'll likely outmatch him collectively because of him being weakened. And not knowing what to do, Goku just gives the signal to Piccolo and Chi-Chi, who reluctantly let his tail go, as they untie Raditz as well. Goku tells Raditz that he wants to give him another chance. Raditz doesn't really know what to do, because if he attacks them, he knows he'll die in the process. If he runs, they'll find him, even though they're probably not intending on killing him right now. He doesn't know why they kept him around anyways. He could contact Vegeta and Nappa as well, but they take a year or more to come here, and he has no scouter because Gohan broke it from headbutting him. Raditz for now will just go with the flow to see what happens. Goku and the group prepare to train to fight the Saiyans, in case they do come, because they might think Raditz is dead and they're gonna want revenge, or they're gonna want to get Goku still because Raditz failed to do so. Raditz is off on his own now and is pretty conflicted. He could try to attack again and face inevitable death, or betray the Saiyans and join his brother and have a chance to survive. Besides, from what Raditz spilled during the interrogation, Goku already knows that Nappa and Vegeta never really accepted Raditz anyways, and the Saiyans may not even come to avenge him for all he knows. They saw him as a weakling. Raditz also realizes that if they come to this planet and find him alive anyway, as well as being an ally with Kakarot and not the Saiyans, they might just see him as being too soft to kill his brother, or just see him as a traitor and kill him regardless. Raditz considers this as he's off on his own for a few days, but then he eventually returns to Goku. He's hesitant, but he joins the group in training, and it turns out to be a great decision. He may not like this situation, but he's slowly becoming stronger, even though there's a lot of tension in the group. No one except Goku is willing to give Raditz a chance at redemption, so he feels kinda isolated too, and is only really training with his brother. However, training for everyone else is going really well. Raditz made a remark that Earth's gravity is a lot lower than planet Vegeta, which is why Goku is so weak, so that gave Bulma an idea. The gravity training room was built way earlier on, and the Z Fighters use it from time to time now, but it takes a lot of adjustment. Goku may not be with King Kai, but he still gets stronger with gravity training, and his power level reaches 10k, because not only is he training in the gravity room earlier than he does with King Kai, but he also can train at higher gravity levels, even though he has no Kaioken. Piccolo is also stronger, at a power level of 6k. Tien is up to 5300, and Chi-Chi is actually one of the stronger ones of the group too, being at about 5100. Krillin reaches 4600, and Yamcha gets to 4300, with Gohan being close behind at surprisingly 4000, since he not only has more motivation to fight and train, but he has a different upbringing, so it's gonna mean he wants to actually do this. Like I mentioned in the last part, he wants to be like his mom and dad. He wants to learn to fight like them and become powerful. Even Chaozu gets stronger, and he reaches a power of 1500, which I know that's not that much, but for Chaozu, that's pretty good. Raditz eventually is accepted by the group, but the good thing for him is he was already used to 10 times gravity, so he's able to train at 20 times gravity and above pretty easily, and he increases his power to about 12k. Greater than his brother, but less of an increase due to his late start. He's not entirely good yet. He's mainly doing this for himself to keep him alive, but he's able to grow somewhat of a relationship with Kakarot, who is very forgiving of him. The rest of the group doesn't fully accept him yet either, but they eventually do over time, and while they don't completely trust them, they at least feel like they have a common enemy. Why else would Raditz be training with them, right? Well, Raditz isn't too keen on fighting the two Saiyans yet, but given the circumstances, he realizes that it might be the only outcome, because of the reasons I stated before. Besides that, after all the times that he's been called a weakling, he wants to prove them wrong. Over this time, he learns to sense and suppress ki, much like everyone else. The year passes, and the Saiyans actually do end up arriving. They're not here to avenge Raditz, no, they don't care about that weakling. They're here for Kakarot. The group that's going there is a bit different. Gohan and the humans are there like normal, with the addition of Goku and Chi-Chi since Goku's not dead or on Snake Way. Raditz isn't actually there this time because he's panicking. Why is that? Didn't he join Goku? He knows Vegeta is more powerful than him, and even with their combined powers, Vegeta can become a great ape and overpower them. And he doesn't actually know how they'll react by seeing him here, or if he should even fight them at all. He had a year to think about this, but he's not even sure if he should go through with it. For now, he's staying at Capsicorp trying to sense power levels as everyone fights, unsure if he should stay out of the fight or become a traitor to the Saiyans. Goku decides to leave the group briefly before they arrive at the battlefield to try and convince Raditz to join them, and if there's any trouble, he's not too far and he'll be able to get back quickly enough in case something goes wrong. The Z Fighters and the Saiyans end up meeting. Vegeta actually stays back for a bit since he doesn't want to attack anyone except for Kakarot anyways, so he lets Nappa have all the fun. Nappa sees here that everyone is weak because their powers are suppressed, with the strongest being Piccolo at a mere 2,000, which is nothing to them. So he starts by having some fun and planting some Cybermen, with Yamcha getting really cocky and trying to take them out himself. This time though, he does it, although he gets a little injured. He's able to kill four of the Cybermen, with one of them actually jumping on his back and trying to blow himself up. Yamcha is quickly able to raise his power before it explodes, and he survives, although it does kinda hurt, and he's actually almost knocked unconscious. He's gonna just stay out of the fight for a bit. So much for Yamcha trying to be cool, but at least he's alive. Krillin then easily dispatches the remaining Cybermen, and then the group is deciding who should attack Nappa. Nappa's getting pretty impatient and angry. He saw Yamcha's power level rise in that brief moment and he wasn't sure why it did that, or if that was just the Cybermen that he was detecting. And he also sees that the group is disrespecting him, so he gets really angry, since he sees that they're treating him as a game since they just want to decide who fights him first. He gets really angry, and he starts off by launching an attack at Gohan since he's a child and he thinks Gohan is the weakest. But that's a pretty bad mistake. It catches Gohan off guard, but he turns around quick and he catches the blast, throws it up in the air, and it knocks him back a little bit, but he's fine, he's pretty much uninjured. But because someone tried to attack her son, Chi-Chi is furious, and her power actually shoots up to 6,000 because Nappa had the audacity to attack her child. This catches Nappa and Vegeta off guard as their scouters sense this huge power, and Chi-Chi launches herself towards Nappa in order to get payback for what he did to Gohan. He can't react in time. Chi-Chi performs a combo of punches and kicks, and eventually launches him up into the air, jumps up to catch him, and fling him back down to the ground like a volleyball. She finishes off this combo with a Kamehameha. Nappa is pretty badly injured, and he tries to stand up. In a fit of rage, Vegeta curses and kills Nappa before he can even get up. He thinks he's too weak.
He was dead weight. I'll kill the woman by myself.
Back at Capsicorp, Goku is talking to Raditz, trying to convince him to join the fight. He tells him to focus on the power levels and see what's going on, and then Raditz senses something that changes his mind instantly. He senses Vegeta killing Nappa. That alone is enough to convince him to actually join Goku. That wasn't something that even Goku expected. If anything, Raditz sees now that Vegeta is the true traitor for doing that. Raditz has no need to hide anymore. He's completely justified in killing Vegeta now because Vegeta is no better than him. Actually, worse. Vegeta actually killed one of the fellow Saiyans. Raditz was only contemplating it. And now this is another good reason for Raditz to actually turn against the Saiyan. The two then head back to the battle. Vegeta powers up, and the entire group also does in response. Piccolo, Tien, and Chi-Chi alone have enough power to nearly match Vegeta's 18,000, just under it. And even with Yamcha knocked out, Krillin, Chaozu, and Gohan put them way over that power level. The group launches a coordinated attack from all sides, with Vegeta first dodging some hits from the weaker ones, but then he eventually loses track of everything since he's being attacked by six people at once from all sides, all of whom are moving in perfect synergy. Just when he thinks he'll be punched in one side, he gets kicked in another, then a hit to his back, then a head, and then his arm, and then his stomach. He's losing track. He's getting hit everywhere, and then he gets beaten down even further. They beat him into the ground until he's nearly unconscious. Has Vegeta actually lost? Not yet. He weakly stands up, and he chuckles to himself.
Was that really all you guys had?
He prepares a powerball in his hand, as everyone puts their guard up, thinking he's about to blow them up or something. Only for him to instead take that ball of ki and fling it up into the air rather than at them. They're very confused at the moment, but then they see Vegeta begin to grow larger and larger and larger. Goku and Raditz sense this from far away, and they realize what's going on. While the group themselves doesn't know what's going on yet, Raditz knows all too well. He shields his eyes as of now, so he doesn't turn into a great ape just yet, and explains to Goku what's happening. They can sense Vegeta's power growing, and that giant glowing ball in the sky is an obvious sign to Raditz of what's going on. Goku, who doesn't have a tail, has no need to worry about it right now. At least not worry about himself transforming, he's obviously got to worry that Vegeta is.
But since he doesn't need to worry about transforming, he helps lead Raditz to the fight so he can get there quickly instead of giving their position away early by transforming himself. They're almost there, and Raditz remembers something crucial. Gohan is at the scene of the fight, and he still has a tail. Back at the fight, the group begins to watch helplessly as Vegeta grows in size and power, laughing as he does so. They can't really do much at the moment except wait it out, so the group is trying desperately to dodge his attacks and focus on defense instead of offense. While being one of the people in the group that's trying to dodge attacks, Gohan ends up evading one of Vegeta's hits. As he looks up to see Vegeta's about to slam his fist on him, with the power ball behind him in the air, Vegeta slams his fist down on Gohan, but then it's caught. Gohan has seen the power ball and is now transforming on his own. Keep in mind, Gohan has a power of 4300 right now, with Vegeta being weakened from the previous fight as well as the use of the power ball. He's still much stronger than Gohan, being just under 180k in power after transforming, maybe closer to 130k. But now Gohan is at 43k, and this can distract Vegeta for a bit, even though there's a difference in power. Gohan, however, can't control his form, not nearly as well as Vegeta. He's completely berserk and begins to attack Vegeta, who struggles to block it at first but eventually regains ground and fights back, once he realizes that Gohan is just throwing punches left and right with no rhyme or reason to it. While this is going on, Goku and Raditz finally arrive at the fight. Vegeta is preoccupied with Gohan, but then sees Raditz below him, which distracts him and lets Gohan get a hit in and knock Vegeta over while off guard. Vegeta is furious to see Raditz here. He thought Raditz was dead, but no. Raditz betrayed him and joined Kakarot of all people. In his anger, he fires a blast powerful enough to actually knock Gohan away and unconscious, sending him out of the form with Chi-Chi going over to help with him. She still really wants to help fight, but Vegeta with this new transformation far outclasses everyone at this point, so the best thing she could do right now is actually help to protect Gohan, who's now defenseless. After Goku talks some sense to him, Raditz now knows that he must face Vegeta. He'll prove that he isn't a weakling anymore. Vegeta is heavily weakened from the prior fight as well as the use of the power ball. So while his maximum power as a Great Ape would be around 180k, like I said before, in this scenario, it's probably a little close to 130k. Raditz now is at a power level of 12k, with Goku at 10k. If Raditz were to transform, him and Goku would nearly be equal to Vegeta and may just win. If they can't defeat him, they can at least distract him. Raditz has informed Goku and the group that they need to sever Vegeta's tail to get him to return to normal. And while the group attempts to do that, he can help hold Vegeta off. They aren't tired out, and Raditz doesn't need to lose power to use the power ball. So as Vegeta charges towards him, Raditz knows what he must do, and he looks up towards the power ball, and then begins to transform. He turns to Goku with a smirk as he transforms. "Let's do this, Kakarot!" Goku nods, and Raditz is now fully grown, and he begins to clash with Vegeta. While Raditz holds the prince off, Goku rallies everyone together. They need to go for Vegeta's tail. With Raditz transformed, they don't need to worry about fighting Vegeta. Chaozu is the weakest there, and he offers to bring Gohan somewhere safe, as well as the unconscious Yamcha. Chi-Chi protests this and wants to stay with Gohan, but Goku tells her that Gohan is in safe hands, and she needs to stay here. She's one of the most powerful Z fighters right now, and this is their only shot to defeat Vegeta. They need all the help they can get, and they can't lose her. She hears about it and understands that this is the only option, and gets serious again. That motivation from Goku was what she needed to get back into the fight. I mean, Vegeta is the one who hurt Gohan after all, and she can't just sit by and do nothing about it. He hurt her son, and she doesn't want to let him get away with it. So now she's back in the fight. The group of Goku, Chi-Chi, Piccolo, Tien, and Krillin all charge together while Raditz fights, swarming Vegeta like a group of bees. You know, because there's a size difference, and they're basically insects to him right now. Raditz was beginning to lose ground due to Vegeta being more experienced and a little bit stronger, but then Vegeta is caught off guard and he's punched in the eye by Goku, who jumped in to help his brother. He swings at Goku, but he can't hit him because of how small he is in comparison, and Raditz uses this opportunity to attack. With one small fighter and a large one, he can't defend against both at once. When he defends against Raditz, he's open for Goku to do whatever he can to attack a weak point on Vegeta with a powerful blast or punch. When he tries to focus on Goku, Raditz is able to hit him as well, and he can't even swing at Goku just because he's so small. All while this is happening, the other four Z fighters are behind Vegeta trying to grab onto his tail and cut it off. They eventually all grab on, and they try to hold it down for Krillin to cut it off, but Vegeta notices this and flicks his tail. By flicking it, he flings everyone away, so they know they can't just do that. they need to find a way to pin his tail down somehow, since what they're doing right now obviously isn't going to work again. While Goku and Raditz fight Vegeta, the group tries to think of a strategy in order to pin the tail down and cut it off. After some thinking, this ends up giving Chi-Chi an idea. While Goku and Raditz are fighting Vegeta, they see something going on behind him. Piccolo is now growing as well. He uses the Great Namekian form, which won't increase his power, but will massively increase his size and weight. Chi-Chi remembered he did this in the fight against Goku years ago, and told him to do so this time. While he doesn't do this to gain an increase in power, the size increase will actually allow him to hold down Vegeta's tail now regardless of his power. Vegeta obviously notices Piccolo growing, and turns around to attack him, but doing so means he gets sloppy, and this gives Raditz a perfect opportunity to knock Vegeta to the ground, by performing a quick sweep to his legs. This causes his legs to give out, as he falls over to the ground. The Z Fighters jump out of the way, so they don't get crushed, and Raditz and Piccolo pin him down with Piccolo holding onto Vegeta's tail, trying to give Krillin a clear shot at it. This is their chance, and now that Vegeta's pinned down, Krillin has a clean shot to the tail. He runs back towards Vegeta, jumps up and charges a Destructo Disc. He lets it fly, and it slices Vegeta's tail clean off, as Piccolo yanks it up and flings it to the side. As Vegeta is shrinking, he lets out one last attack aimed at random, a mouth blast that ends up hitting Krillin. Goku shouts out for Krillin, but it's too late. The beam was more than enough to kill him, and he couldn't dodge it. Vegeta is now underneath Piccolo and Raditz, back down to normal size. While the group beat him, he did take Krillin down with him as well as one last dirty trick. While Vegeta's pinned down by Raditz and Piccolo, everyone else rushes over to Krillin to try and save him, but nothing could be done. Even revenge would be pointless at this point as Vegeta's already defeated, and it's not something Goku would normally do anyways. At the mercy of Raditz and Piccolo, who aren't as kind as Goku, Vegeta looks up at them and lets out a chuckle. Raditz realizes how foolish he was to ever side with Vegeta, someone who has no respect towards life, and no respect towards him. And now he killed the best friend of his brother, the same person who took him in and gave him a second chance, and did more for him than Vegeta did in his whole life. He looks to Piccolo, who knows what he wants to do, and Piccolo steps back. Raditz picks up Vegeta, staring through him. In his deep grade 8 voice, he says,
"Who's the weakling now?"
He prepares a mouth beam, and gives Vegeta the same fate as Krillin, completely disintegrating the prince. This catches the attention of the others, who are mourning Krillin, and it gives them mixed feelings. Chi-Chi, Piccolo, and Tien saw it as necessary that Vegeta would be taken care of. He did nearly kill everyone else, and he actually did manage to kill Krillin, not to mention he helped destroy a city and injured Yamcha and Gohan, and probably committed countless other atrocities. They couldn't just forgive him right away. Piccolo being Piccolo wouldn't have an issue with this, and Chi-Chi and Tien just see it as a rational choice given the things he's done. But Goku feels different. He's disappointed in Raditz for killing Vegeta, since he personally wouldn't do that, but he does understand why Raditz would do that, and that Raditz didn't mean anything bad by it. If anything, Raditz did it to try to help Goku. Vegeta treated Raditz awfully. By doing this, he would get some closure for himself and kinda avenging Krillin too. Goku's mainly disappointed because he just wished he had a say in it, since Raditz just went ahead and did it, and Piccolo obviously had no issue with letting it happen either. It's what Raditz personally thought was right. The real issue now is that Krillin is dead, and there's no way to bring him back since the Dragon Balls won't work on him. Trying to make up for killing Vegeta, Raditz has a suggestion for his brother. If the Dragon Balls come from the Namekians like Piccolo and Kami, then they might have a chance at finding more Dragon Balls if they go to a planet called Namek to see if they have their own, because they're Namekians as well. Potentially, this could bring Krillin back. Piccolo agrees with this idea, as it would be kinda nice for him to visit his home planet and learn about its culture, and since they can't revive Krillin with the normal Dragon Balls that they have. Chi-Chi agrees to this as well, and even offers to go to Namek with them in case they need some help. She could bring Gohan as well, since it'd be a nice opportunity for him to study alien life and work towards his goal of being a scholar. Maybe he'll make a groundbreaking discovery. They don't see any danger in it as of now. Seeing it as the only way, Goku thanks Raditz for this idea, and they decide that they should go. However, they need to prepare first. Before they can even head to Namek, they actually need to find where Namek is and get a ship to go there. With some help from Kami and Popo like usual, and Bulma's research, work begins on a Namekian ship, with some astronomy, physics, and some research on the ships, as well as some intense R&D. Bulma and Dr. Briefs are able to locate Namek and program the ship to fly there, and they modify it to make it better suited to hold the group. With the gravity room being built prior, the ship has its own gravity chamber implemented in it,
and it's bigger to accommodate everyone training. This time, a much larger group is heading to Namek than originally. Goku, Chi-Chi, Gohan, Raditz, Tien, Yamcha, Piccolo, and Bulma. It's gonna be packed. However, I want to bring up an interesting event that's been happening over the course of the last few months and during the ship's development, and it starts to escalate. Something that's been happening low-key in the past year, and starts to happen more during the few weeks of the ship's development. With Yamcha being basically absent from her life, and Vegeta dying and never even being an option, Bulma now has her sights set on a new potential boyfriend. Raditz? Given that the two associate so much through Goku, and the fact that both their personalities act somewhat similarly to how Vegeta and Bulma's worked, this ends up being a relationship that happens. A lot of you actually suggested this in the comments of the previous parts, and I was considering it, and when you think about it, it honestly makes a lot of sense. This way, we can let my boy Raditz have a little bit of fun, without me stealing Mosco X's idea of setting him up with Launch. He did it first and better than anyone, so there's no way I'm gonna copy it. But Raditz and Bulma? It kinda works. In terms of the other members of the group, they get some training while the ship is being built as well. Piccolo, now becoming a good guy, kinda like Raditz, ends up forming a bond with Tien and Yamcha. Given their devotion to martial arts and empowering themselves, Tien and Piccolo start getting along with each other, and that extends to Yamcha through Tien's friendship with him. The three begin to train a lot together, and form a trio instead of just the duo before. This also kinda includes Chaozu, but Chaozu's starting to get out of his league. On the other side of things, Chi-Chi begins to train with Goku a lot more, and often, they'll be joined by Gohan, of course, and occasionally Raditz. Goku, Chi-Chi, and Gohan spend way more time together than they do originally, and are a lot stronger than before. Raditz is only occasionally with them because other times, he'll be training with other fighters, or potentially hanging out with Bulma and doing some other kind of training. The ship is finally finished, and the group heads off to Namek. The ship was modified to be more efficient and took some time to fix, but it'll arrive to Namek around the same time as Bulma, Krillin, and Gohan landed originally. In the meantime, the group has nothing to do on the ship except train, so you know what that means. Power levels. Yamcha is at 23,000, Gohan 28,000, or 280,000 when grade 8, Chi-Chi 30,000, Tien 30,000, Piccolo at 35,000, Raditz at 50,000, or 500,000 when grade 8, and finally we end off with Goku at 52,000. The gravity training before and after getting on the ship has begun to increase everyone's power noticeably. Goku has basically been doing nothing but training, and surpassed his brother in terms of base power, since Raditz did lose some training time. The humans and Piccolo got much more powerful as well, especially Chi-Chi, who had the advantage of training with Goku most of the time. Something interesting is different about Gohan this time. He still has his tail. During his fight with Vegeta, he only returned to normal because he was knocked out, and they never actually had to cut it off. Having Raditz around, Raditz is actually trying to train his nephew to use the transformation effectively since he still has the tail to do it. Gohan is now able to use the form somewhat effectively when there's a full moon, but again that's only when there's a full moon or if Raditz creates a power ball, and he doesn't have complete control over it yet, but it's a good start because he actually is somewhat conscious while using it. Now, after their journey, the group arrives on Namek and begins their hunt for the Dragon Balls. But this isn't like normal. Namek is what Namek should be right now, very quiet and peaceful. The group of Z Fighters are the only ones here at the moment, and Frieza isn't, not that they expected him to be here. Why is that? Well, the Dragon Balls were never mentioned to Vegeta or Nappa, or Raditz when he had a scouter for that matter. This means Frieza would never have found out about the Dragon Balls, and he wouldn't have known that they existed on Namek, so right now the best he knows is that there's some sort of legend, so he didn't go to search for the Dragon Balls right away. Namek is completely empty right now, except for the Namekians. Being able to sense Ki and track down some villages, and knowing that there's 7 Dragon Balls, with 8 of them there, the group splits up with each member task finding one Dragon Ball, then meeting back at the ship. As for Bulma, the 8th member, she stays behind on the ship to be safe. The search goes pretty smoothly. They're able to find villages with Dragon Balls and learn about them, and since the Namekians know their wish and that they have good intentions, everyone's able to get a Dragon Ball pretty easily. Given that they want to help their guests, and that they have a noble cause of bringing their friend back, and they've traveled a long way, the Namekians send one of the children, Dende, along with the group to help them summon Purunga. Sadly though, no one gets their potential unlocked by Guru because there's simply no reason at all at the moment, or any reason for them to find out that he has that power anyways. Not even Dende will get that. Given the fact that there's no chaos and, you know, the planet's actually not blowing up this time, they're actually able to summon Purunga right now. Since they don't need all of the three wishes, and they want the Namekians to have their Dragon Balls back soon, they only wish for Krillin to come back because that's really all they need right now. Overall, the Namek Saga is pretty uneventful because Vegeta's dead and Frieza doesn't intervene. That doesn't mean the group doesn't know about Frieza though, or that he's not a threat. Raditz does know about Frieza, and he's been thinking a lot recently about the fact that he hasn't showed up yet. The group then returns home, getting some more training in on their way back as all they can do is really train. Given that they're not training as seriously on their trip back, as they know there's no danger on Earth, their power doesn't increase as dramatically as the first trip. Yamcha at 50k, Gohan at 60k, Chi-Chi at 70k, Tien at 70k, Piccolo at 80k, Raditz at 120k, and Goku at 125k. At best, their power increases just over double, but they're all pretty powerful nonetheless. Sadly, Krillin is on Earth and is left behind for the training until they end up getting back, but they'll catch him up to speed. At least he's alive again, and he wasn't really dead for that long. But he actually learned a new trick in the afterlife. I'll cover that in a bit. As for Raditz, when I mentioned before that he knows about Frieza, he's warned the group about Frieza multiple times, even when he first met them. He's particularly worried right now though. Frieza's been pretty quiet. Raditz is anxious that Frieza may come back to Earth because Vegeta died there, so Vegeta might see the planet as a threat. Or, in the best case scenario, Frieza doesn't care about Earth and is actually glad that Vegeta and Nappa died, and that Raditz is supposedly dead. This means no more Saiyans for him to worry about. We'll also get to that later. It'll be important. Given that there's no threat on Earth at the moment, life is pretty peaceful. Chi-Chi becoming a Z-Fighter actually led to a peaceful period in time where there weren't any threats or massive battles, at least after Vegeta died there weren't. For the next year and a half after returning from Namek, life goes pretty smoothly. We now go to age 764. Everyone continues their training and becomes stronger, but before I get into that, there's a few more things that happened during this time. Given all the time they have together now and the period of peace, Goku and Chi-Chi actually decide to have another kid. Since she doesn't need a fight at the moment, it's not that big of a risk for Chi-Chi to actually go through with having another kid. So because of this, Chi-Chi's now pregnant with Goten at age 764, earlier than she was originally. And in the meantime, in a similar fashion, Bulma and Raditz's relationship begins to go further, and similar to her relationship with Vegeta, she's now expecting a child too. But besides that, let's get into everyone's current power. Given the peacetime, people haven't really been training as efficiently as you'd expect in the 1.5 years. Yamcha's at 150k, Chi-Chi at 160k, Krillin minimum is at 190k, I'll get into that in a bit, Tien at 250k, Gohan at 260k or 2.6 million when grade 8, Piccolo at 280,000, Raditz at 320,000 or 3.2 million as a grade 8, and Goku at 350,000. As you can see, they all got a nice boost in power, but a few fell behind. With her now expecting a kid, Chi-Chi has to go light on the training and eventually stop for a bit. Gohan and Piccolo benefit most from this training, with them being a lot friendlier now and Gohan using his downtime to train with Piccolo, as well as Tien, and Yamcha when he decides not to slack off. And remember I mentioned Krillin had a new trick? Well, Krillin was able to catch up with everyone, but now with people slacking, he doesn't get as far ahead as he should. But he didn't have a lot of time to practice this, and it was only a few weeks, so he can't teach anyone else this trick. But Krillin has something pretty cool now, Kaioken. When he died, even though he was only there for a few weeks, he got some training in with King Kai. It took him about a day or two to travel across Snake Way, but in the time he was with King Kai, King Kai decided to teach him only Kaioken because that was the most important thing right now, and he knew that Krillin was going to get revived soon, so he really only had time to teach him this. Given he had such little time to use it though, he can only do about 5 times right now, and if he really needs to, he could push it to times 10, but it will cause immense strain on him. While there's this nice period of peace, someone is about to change everything. We're in age 764, which means Trunks arrives in the past, and he sees no one's around. No Frieza, no Z Fighters. Weird. Did he get the time wrong? He goes off to Capsule Corp to see what's going on, and he meets Bulma and immediately knows something has changed in this timeline when he sees she's pregnant. Bulma then calls everyone to Capsule Corp to meet this visitor. Trunks is very confused right now. Vegeta is dead, his mom and Goku's brother are together, and Gohan's mom is a Z Fighter and is also having a kid right now. What went on in this timeline that changed everything?
He asks where Frieza is, and no one knows.
And this brings Raditz's anxiety back. He explains that they haven't seen Frieza at all, and Trunks finds out everything that happened and knows that this timeline is completely wrong, and realizes that he'd traveled to a different timeline and not backwards in his own timeline. However, he still does want to help. He then proceeds to show off Super Saiyan, and this worries him the most, because no one knows what he's doing right now. Trunks has a lot of explaining now as he proceeds to tell them about Super Saiyans and how the androids are coming soon. While hoping this timeline won't seem his own, it's better for him to help these guys out and not let them die. Besides, if he helps them, it may benefit him somehow. Trunks prepares to leave and gives Goku his medicine. While he didn't go to Yardrat, I'm gonna say Goku still needs the medicine because it's never confirmed if he got the heart virus on Yardrat or not. Given how he basically lived like an animal as a child, it's entirely possible that Goku contracted the heart virus because of that rather than on Yardrat. Either way, I'm gonna keep that in the story and say he'll get it later on. Now, the group needs to begin training again and get serious, as Goku, Raditz, and Gohan need to find out how to become a Super Saiyan now. Trunks returns to his time, and he will return in 3 years. One thing that doesn't really sit right with him, though, is the fact that he might not exist in this timeline, or at least not as he knows himself now. Even if Bulma's child is going to be called Trunks by name, he'll be a completely different person. During the 3 years, the group begins to train right away, and Chi-Chi joins back in as often as she can after Goten is born. She's not around as much during training, since she didn't expect that she even needed to train during this time, which is why she decided to have a kid in the first place. Occasionally, Bulma will offer some help taking care of Goten with whatever babysitter she used for Trunks, or Ox King will help. But Chi-Chi still does need to take care of Goten, and she falls behind a bit in training because of it. Speaking of that, Trunks is born as well, and he's still named Trunks. He looks pretty much the same right now, but when he grows up, he's gonna begin to look and act different, since Raditz is his father instead of Vegeta. Raditz and Piccolo have become more friendly through training, and they train a lot with Goku and Gohan. The four of them are pretty close now, given that three of them are related and Piccolo is friendly with all of them. Their goal now is to get the Saiyans to act as Super Saiyan. The humans still train as well, with Krillin learning to increase his Kaioken even higher. All is going well, but something different will happen during these 3 years. Off in space, Frieza has been wondering what happened with those Saiyans that went to Earth. It's been over a year and they haven't returned. They should have been back by now. He gave them some extra time, thinking that they were running into some trouble, but they haven't contacted Frieza. He can only think of two outcomes. They either deserted the Frieza Force, or they're dead. Either way, he needs to head to Earth and get some business done. In the poll I left at the end of the last part, I asked whether or not Frieza would go to Earth during the 3 years, and a majority of you voted that he will show up during this time skip. So now, he decides to go off to Earth. About a year or so since Trunks has arrived, training is going well and is getting more intense. While only at Grade 1, Goku was the first person able to unlock Super Saiyan. Soon after, Raditz was able to get it alongside with his brother. Their goal now is to train with it as much as possible, and get Gohan to unlock it next. Chi-Chi has also started to train more, but not as much as before. In terms of power, power levels are irrelevant right now, but she's the third strongest human behind Tien and Krillin since she missed out on some training. Once she begins training more and more, she eventually gets a new outfit that's similar to Goku's as she starts to get back into it. Goten is now one, and still needs some care from Chi-Chi while everyone trains, but she's adjusted her schedule so that Goten gets the care he needs, and she still has some training time. This is a big deal, and she needs to be strong enough to handle it, or else they'll all probably die. Unlike in the original story, her mindset is different this time. World is at whereas before she didn't even want Gohan training despite the fact that the world was at stake. But in this timeline, she realizes the threat and wants to train to prevent it from happening. During the training, they all sense something approaching, and Raditz knows exactly what it is. He hasn't sensed Frieza's ki before because he didn't know how to sense ki back then, but once he sees the ships arriving, he knows for sure that it's the Frieza Force. But he honestly isn't too worried. There are more than strong enough to easily kill Frieza, and if they work fast enough, King Cold won't be an issue either. The two of them are basically training dummies for them. Frieza steps out of the ship with King Cold at his side. They're greeted by Goku, Gohan, Raditz, and Piccolo. Only knowing Raditz, Frieza ends up finding out what happened and that Vegeta and Nappa have died, and Raditz actually did desert the Frieza Force. This angers Frieza, but he doesn't care. It gives him an excuse to dispose of these monkeys. Goku tells Frieza that his fight is with him and Gohan, while Raditz and Piccolo face King Cold for the time being. For some training, Goku lets Gohan fight Frieza first. Even though Gohan's in base, with all the training and the time that has passed since the last few parts,
Gohan's able to actually fight first form Frieza pretty well. Frieza is annoyed and eventually goes into his second and third form, and Gohan begins to lose ground but still holds his own. Goku sees that it's becoming too much as Frieza becomes more and more violent and tries to power up further, so Goku ends up stepping in to fight Frieza himself. Frieza ends up going all the way to his final form, with Goku still in base. Knowing Frieza will probably destroy the planet if he drags this out too long, Goku ends up going Super Saiyan and killing Frieza after the fight goes on for a bit. It was easy for him, and once he actually transformed, Frieza was nothing to Goku. It was a good way for him to gauge his and Gohan's power. He goes to check up on Raditz to see how he's doing, and Goku sees that Raditz is just sitting there in Super Saiyan, with Piccolo looking completely speechless. The area is empty except for a big crater, with King Cold's cape lying on the ground, and there's no trace of him other than that. Raditz had a little bit too much fun with this and decided to go Super Saiyan right away, not actually realizing how strong he was in this form. But he's gauged his power now, so even though he accidentally killed King Cold a little too quickly, he's still got a little something out of it. And since they arrived on Earth now, that'll affect a certain android in the future, since the drones of Dr. Gero now have access to the DNA of Frieza and King Cold, which is something that they didn't have before. Raditz is pretty happy about this. Now the Frieza Force is essentially nothing, and he doesn't have to worry about Frieza anymore like he was in the last parts. He didn't even realize that Frieza posed no threat to them at this point. Training continues, and this battle gave them some brief insight and experience. Well, at least for Goku and Gohan it did. It also made Raditz realize, why is he still wearing his Frieza Force armor? He doesn't need these anymore, so it's time for him to get a change of clothes, and Piccolo gives him a clothes beam. Raditz's new outfit is inspired both by his friend and brother, having a similar look to Goku's, but with the color scheme of Piccolo's. Now, the training resumes and everyone grows exponentially further. Before the 3 years end, Gohan is just about able to use Super Saiyan and is prepared for the androids. Chi-Chi has also begun training a lot more, almost as much as she did in the beginning of the series, but still not being fully devoted again. Also, she makes sure that Goku takes his heart virus medicine as he soon begins to show signs of the heart issues. Having her around when training means that Goku's never gonna fully experience the virus, and he won't go out of commission during the fight with the androids. He's cured already. Speaking of which, the day arrives and the androids are now in the city. Knowing that it's time, the group of Z Fighters heads over and begins to search for the androids. This encounter goes pretty much like normal, up until Goku's fight with 19 at least. In the city, they find the androids and then move outside to fight, and Goku starts off by facing Android 19. Goku doesn't fall ill this time because he took the medication before, and he's able to figure out 19's ability and ends up killing him. I know Goku doesn't usually kill people, but in terms of Frieza, that was a big threat that he needed to take care of, and as for Android 19, he's not really a person, so I don't think Goku would have any qualms about killing him. I just wanted to bring that up because during the writing of this what if, I realized that's something I should address in case people are questioning why Goku's going around killing people this time. But yeah, he knows when he needs to dispose of a certain threat. After Goku defeats 19, Raditz is about to face Gero, but Gero created a diversion to escape, and Trunks shows up soon after. Trunks is pretty amazed to see how well their training went. With how good they all were as training partners, Goku and Raditz far surpass how strong Goku was in canon, especially since Goku is completely healthy here, and the heart virus didn't inhibit his training in any way. Even though the androids here are different, Trunks is confident because of everyone's power. The most shocking one to him is Gohan, who is almost as powerful as Trunks himself thanks to all the training. Piccolo and Krillin are actually a lot stronger too, and they felt like they could take down 19 and 20 themselves, which just shows how strong they are. Chi-Chi has also gotten back on track in terms of training, is behind Krillin in terms of strength, mainly because Krillin has Kaioken. This part also goes pretty much routine, and Gero is able to awaken the androids. When seeing the androids, the Z Fighters are now fearful seeing how easily the two androids killed Gero, and once they awaken 16, it just instills more fear into them. At this point in the scenario, I'd like to rank everyone as this. 16, 17, and 18 are above Goku, with Raditz close behind, and Trunks behind Raditz, and close to Trunks is Gohan. 19 and 20 are far below them, and are equal in power to Krillin and Piccolo, at least when Krillin's using Kaioken. Following behind Krillin is Chi-Chi, then Tien, and a little farther behind is Yamcha. And even for the people like Tien and Yamcha who are below the rest of the group, they're still a lot stronger than they were in the original story. While everyone could tell that each android is way stronger than them, the Z Fighters still need to fight and defeat them. The androids are hunting Goku, and since he's right there, they don't go off and they start to fight them right away. Since the androids are fighting them right here and now, the Z Fighters have an issue because they're way outmatched and they have to escape somehow. They need to prevent the androids from killing Goku. While they hold the androids off for a bit, it's not enough. From the lookout, Kami is watching all this happen. Knowing how dire everything is, he begins to speak to everyone while they fight. He tells them to find a way to escape by throwing up some sort of smokescreen, as he wants Goku to lead everyone to the lookout once they escape. Hearing this, Krillin and Tien step in front of everyone to do a solar flare together, while everyone else throws ki blasts at the ground to create lots of smoke clouds. When the android's vision comes back, all they see is a bunch of smoke, and the Z Fighters are gone. Now they need to find where Goku went. The diversion works, and Goku is leading everyone to the lookout while they suppress their ki while flying, not knowing if the androids can sense them, but wanting to be safe just in case they can. They arrive and fly up to the lookout, knowing they'll be safe for now. Kami greets them and instantly tells them that he has a solution for everything happening right now. It involves the time chamber, which Goku's already pretty familiar with. At the lookout, Kami informs everyone that they should head into the Room of Spirit and Time immediately, with Goku remembering it from when he was a child. He knows how effective it is, and he's glad Kami called them up here. The androids are way too strong, and no one right now can actually face them, but maybe this would actually help them. However, it's a little odd this time deciding who will go inside, and you'll see what I mean as we get into it. Given how prevalent the humans are in the story, everyone is motivated to train in here and help out. The people who need the most training though are Goku, Raditz, Gohan, and Trunks. Chi-Chi, Piccolo, and Krillin want to go in as well. So first, Goku ends up going in with Gohan and Chi-Chi. It's basically like a family vacation of sorts, just a really weird one. Both Goku and Chi-Chi know that she's a little bit behind, so Goku decides it would be best to get her to catch up first, and she agrees, obviously. Goku's goal for himself is to access a level beyond Super Saiyan, and he feels like, no matter who he goes in with, he might be able to increase his power just because of how effective the training is. And having Gohan there is good too, obviously, because Gohan would be a strong training partner, and the two of them could work together and both access a higher level of Super Saiyan. So without hesitation, these three are the first to go in. The only issue is that there's not enough food. With some help from Popo and Kami, they're able to get some more food in there to feed the three of them, but they're going to end up leaving a bit early because of this, as well as a few other reasons that I'll get into later. So who's next? Well, Raditz would go in with Trunks because they're the next strongest, but their dynamic is a little weird right now, and spending a year together isn't really what they want to do. This version of Trunks isn't really the future version of Raditz's son, it's a version of Trunks with Vegeta as his father. This was equally weird for both Raditz and Trunks, and both are just kinda, well, uncomfortable at the thought of training together for a year. Understandably, it's very awkward. But luckily, there's an easy solution for right now. For Raditz, he's gonna go in with Piccolo, given the two of them are good training partners and good friends. As for Piccolo, he actually doesn't merge with Kami at the moment. Yeah, Piccolo is still his original self and never merged with Nail, so the idea doesn't really even pop in his head. Kami doesn't bring it up either, even though he might know it. On the other hand, Trunks decides to head in with Krillin. It's a bit of an odd choice, but Krillin's new technique, Kaioken, could prove useful if Trunks can somehow learn it. But Trunks also does realize that this form is kinda useless to him, at least right now, since Super Saiyan is a greater multiplier with less stamina drain. The only reason I'm mentioning Kaioken is that this will benefit Krillin mostly, since the use of it will allow him to keep up with Trunks, and Krillin might be able to actually push this multiplier higher and get stronger himself. But mainly, he really has no other option unless he wants to spend a really awkward year with Raditz, since he knows the other three won't head in for another year. However, something strange happens while these guys are training. The others on the lookout sense a strange energy, and they encounter it, finding Cell. The encounter goes pretty routine, except it's not just Piccolo there, and the group now knows about his existence and is worried about him finding the androids. They need to actually find and stop the androids quick, before Cell can get to them. In under a day, Goku, Chi-Chi, and Gohan exit the room, and the difference is quite apparent. Chi-Chi has grown exponentially stronger, and so have Goku and Gohan. The family training was very effective. One thing that everyone picks up on is that Goku and Gohan exit the room in Super Saiyan, and seem to be controlling it particularly well. Oh yeah, they don't have that Saiyan armor this time either, just their normal clothes. Gohan actually has a change of clothes and is wearing the same as his parents. You know, kinda like what he was wearing before and what he's wearing in the BoJack movie. He and Goku have accessed Super Saiyan Grade 4, aka the mastered version of Super Saiyan, and they're now far stronger than before. Chi-Chi, who is behind most of the others before, is now way stronger, just around the level of base Trunks. Keep in mind, this is base Trunks, not like she's Super Saiyan Trunks level or anything, but this is still impressive. Had she been a Saiyan with Super Saiyan, she would have been one of the strongest characters at this point. The training definitely did pay off, and well, they feel confident enough to actually fight the androids now. They're way beyond their level. You might have noticed I mentioned that they were only in there for under a day, about 8 months in the time chamber. Well, this is particularly due to the food, but also, Gohan already had a little jump start on Super Saiyan, and Gohan getting grade 4 as well as Goku wasn't really too hard since they didn't need to try and train Gohan to get Super Saiyan in the first place. Really, their main goal was to actually get this new form of Super Saiyan, and they got that pretty early on. Plus, they felt their training was enough. Chi-Chi got stronger, they got their new forms, so they decided to just leave early. It's no point staying in there for long. The only other thing they could do is have Gohan and Goku train rigorously in this new form, but they couldn't really do that because that would just be ignoring Chi-Chi and then she'd be stuck in there for another 4 months. Besides, at the moment, they don't really feel it's necessary. They're already far strong enough to face the androids. However, they end up hearing the news of Cell once they're on the lookout, and realize he may be a greater threat than they could have even imagined for the androids. Piccolo and Raditz go in next, with the Sun family and everyone else spending their time searching for the androids. They need to find the androids before Cell, and they have the perfect bait, Goku. However, he's also bait for Cell, so it's a little risky to just have Goku announce his location to the androids. So they just decide to search like normal, and if Goku ends up being good bait, well, so be it. They'll actually be able to use that in their favor. But they're not having any luck at all, and it's worrying because if they don't find the androids soon, Cell will, and who knows what'll happen then. A day goes by and Raditz and Piccolo join the search, Raditz now having mastered Super Saiyan as well. Piccolo is far stronger than before, but nothing too exceptional since he doesn't have Nail or Kami merge with him. But for Raditz, he got the new form, but he didn't really get too much stronger from this training, cause Piccolo is a lot weaker than he was. I mean, sure, getting mastered Super Saiyan is great, but he also didn't get to train his base form along with it and get stronger just by himself, so it's kind of a drawback here, and this will bite him in the ass later. Trunks and Krillin are now in the Room of Spirit and Time, and the group continues looking for the androids. Unluckily for them, their fears are realized. In the distance, the Z-Fighter senses a sudden surge in power, followed by a massive explosion. Yeah, this obviously doesn't look good. That's never really a good sign. They arrive and they find exactly what they were hoping wouldn't happen. Cell got the jump on the androids and was able to absorb 17, and proceeded to fight 16 while 18 tried to escape. However, he was able to outmaneuver the two and dismember 16 while grabbing 18, who he just absorbed. 16 attempted to fight Cell, but it was no use and that explosion was Cell just finishing off the robot. Cell then notices Goku, glad to see that there's an audience here to witness his transformation. It's all so perfect. Cell begins to change and is finally in his perfect form. The group was too late. Had they found the androids sooner, they could have stopped them and Cell. Everyone is a little weaker in this timeline. Not by a lot, but it's still noticeable. So while Goku or Gohan in the original story may have been able to take on Cell right now and have a somewhat even fight, it's not really worth the risk in this timeline. Well, it's fine. Goku can just instant transmission out of there and be safe, right? Nope. Goku never went to Yardrat in this scenario, so I feel it's worth mentioning that he lacks this technique now. It'll have consequences later on, not that it really matters right now. Well, yeah, they think they're pretty much dead right now seeing Cell right there. But Cell is actually kinda amused. He can feel that he's perfect now and the power is amazing. So much so that it might make this fight with Goku boring. He could just kill Goku on the spot right now like he wanted, but that's not gonna be fun. He smirks, acknowledging his superiority. He turns to the present Z-Fighters.
3 days. What? I'll give you all 3 days to prepare and face me. I want to have a little fun with this newfound power, so I'll be announcing the Cell games. What are you talking about, Cell? Tune into my Twitch channel later tonight for more details, and don't forget to join my free gift card giveaway.
Cell flies off as he prepares to make his announcement, leaving the Z-Fighters in shock. This time, the Cell games are happening, but the group has much less time to prepare. Given that Goku and Gohan are just underneath the level that they were in canon, Cell feels that they're already strong enough and that 3 days is more than enough time for them to prepare. That's right, 3 days instead of 10. This is a big issue though. Together, Goku, Gohan, and Raditz might be able to take on Cell a little bit, but it's not certain. Goku and Gohan are weaker here like I said, and Raditz might have the new Super Saiyan form down, but he doesn't really have the power to back it up. This is all because they underestimated their enemies, and while training with Chi-Chi greatly benefited her, it meant Goku and Gohan didn't get as much time to train together. Plus the fact that they didn't realize that Cell would be this big of a threat. They thought the power that they got would be just enough because they only knew that the androids were out there. Just like Raditz, they accessed Super Saiyan Grade 4, but they got less higher levels of training this time, since they also focus on training with Chi-Chi. So they're falling behind now and realizing that they might have gotten too overconfident. Maybe if they had extra training, they'd be enough to defeat Cell. But they shouldn't have left early, because this version of Cell is too much. The group returns to the lookout for now, seeing no other option. Raditz feels a little guilt too. He should have just trained with Trunks, and maybe he'd be stronger, as well as Trunks being stronger too. Raditz decides that he's going in for another year. And Trunks and Krillin actually exit the Room of Spirit in time early, and as soon as Trunks exits, Raditz pulls him back in there before Trunks could even say anything. The two of them will just have to suck it up. The awkwardness and the tension between them doesn't really matter when the Earth is at stake. They slacked off before, and now they're paying the price, so it's time to head in the Room of Spirit in time again. I might as well mention it now, but the training wasn't nearly as effective for Trunks. He got stronger, but not as much as he could have gotten. He made a huge miscalculation, and really, this year of training was only beneficial for Krillin, who increases multiplier of Kaioken all the way up to times 50, which is on par with Super Saiyan, but he can't use it for a while due to the stamina drain. He's really only good with times 20 right now. And actually, it wasn't even a year of training. They left early like Goku and Gohan, but this time, they only left after 6 months, since they didn't feel this training was effective for either of them. And Krillin felt like he was holding Trunks back, and suggested that he should just train with Raditz instead. Well, it looks like that's happening now. The two of them begin to get along after about a month, and initially, it's very odd. You might also be asking, and have Krillin train with Piccolo? Well, consider how it feels for these two characters. First of all, they initially didn't think that such rigorous training was necessary after seeing how far Goku and Gohan got with only 8 months and how they were able to surpass the androids. They didn't know about Cell at this point. But also, just look at it from Trunks' perspective. In this timeline, Raditz killed Trunks' dad and then beefed his mom. Yeah, that's kind of messed up. Of course, Trunks is going to feel odd about that. On top of that, Raditz caused Goku to die in Trunks' timeline and never reformed as a person, so Trunks isn't very keen on trusting him yet. On the other hand, Raditz feels weird too just because, well, this version of Trunks is from a timeline where Raditz dies, Vegeta completely brushes it off, and then beefs his wife. There's a lot of disrespect being felt here, and it feels like Vegeta's just coming back from the grave to torment Raditz. But that doesn't matter. They need to put that aside and just work on training together. Luckily, the two of them both have something to offer. On one hand, Raditz has mastered Super Saiyan so he can teach that to Trunks, while Trunks will act as an effective training partner for Raditz. This training will definitely be beneficially mutual, since now Trunks can finally master Super Saiyan, and Raditz can become much stronger with an extra year of training and surpass his brother, and potentially Cell. You might also be asking, didn't Trunks learn Kaioken from Krillin? And couldn't he just teach it to Raditz? Well, yeah, he kinda learned the fundamentals of it, but like I said before, it's not really that useful for him. It doesn't feel like a technique he's gonna use a lot in the future, because the multiplier isn't that great, and also there's a huge stamina drain from it. That's why I didn't even want to cover it in the first place and say that Trunks just flat out learned it, because it would be kind of useless for him to actually do that. That's part of the reason he also left early, because he realized that going in with Krillin wasn't really that great of an idea. He should focus on Super Saiyan rather than some other technique that won't even benefit him that much. And I mean, yeah, he could try and stack it on top of Super Saiyan, but that would probably end up killing him, especially since he's so new to using Kaioken. It's kind of like the Super Saiyan Grade 3 situation, where they realize the form is powerful, like Super Kaioken would be, but it's just not worth using in battle. And of course, Kaioken's kind of useless for him because Super Saiyan's a better multiplier and it has less stamina drain. Well, enough talk about that. After the day passes, they exit and Raditz is excessively confident now. Raditz has surpassed his brother with this training. In his perfective Super Saiyan form, he's just a little bit stronger than Goku now, and he's actually close to the level of Perfect Cell. Now he's not far behind his brother and nephew. This training has been very sporadic so far. The Sun family was only in for about 8 months, Raditz was in with Piccolo for a year, Trunks was in with Krillin for 6 months, and now, Trunks was in with Raditz for a year. Having regret for slacking off, and seeing how strong Raditz became with his effective training, Chi-Chi suggests that Goku should go back in for a few more months with Gohan alone. Not only would it be good training, but it would be some good father-son bonding time. Not to mention, she feels like it would be better for them to train right now and worry about catching her up to speed later. Plus, she also has Goten at home who she hasn't seen in a while, and she can't just be away from her new child for this whole time. Goku and Gohan don't really want to torture themselves with another full year of training, so they decide to just make up for the time that they left early, and just go in for a few more hours or months. which ends up being about 4 months or 8 hours. Mr. Popo is getting tired of all this nonsense. Stocking the room with food, people leaving early, just make up your mind already. He should just take care of Cell himself so he doesn't have to deal with this nonsense, but Kami doesn't really mind. Anyways, Goku and Gohan now exit stronger than before, and the group feels confident to take on Cell. With just over a day until the Cell games, they decide to rest up beforehand and coordinate. The Sun family takes this day to have a family feast, with everyone joining. It's nice to have this nice peaceful moment since they haven't had it in a while. Goku, Gohan, and Chi-Chi get to spend time with Goten, which they haven't in a while, so they don't have to worry about saving Earth anymore just for this brief period of time. I mean, obviously they will tomorrow. And obviously, the rest of the Z Fighters get to enjoy this peacetime as well, kinda like they had before Frieza's arrival. It's crazy how it all went to shit so quickly. This short peacetime passes, and the Day of Fate is now here.
I know from the last part it was a little bit confusing with all the shenanigans in the Room of Spirit and Time, but it actually works out in the end, especially for the non-Saiyans. So in terms of power, well, Gohan is actually the strongest like in the original story, but he is a little bit weaker than where he was originally. As for Goku and Raditz, they're actually very close behind Gohan, and are on par with each other. Behind that is Trunks, and below him is everyone else. Chi-Chi is the strongest human in base right now. However, Krillin is able to become stronger when using Kaioken, but he can't do that for too long. Behind that is Piccolo, and then behind Piccolo is Tien, and then Yamcha. So even with the mess of everyone jumping around in the Room of Spirit and Time, it ends up working out since the lesser used characters are actually a lot stronger here. While the same characters are actually a bit weaker than they were in canon, pretty much everyone else is stronger than where they were before. The Mr. Satan stuff happens like normal, but the Dragon Team arrives to fight Cell. Cell is glad to see them, and he's been waiting for an actual challenge. Goku is about to step up, but he's stopped when someone puts an arm in front of him.
Allow me to do the honors, Kakarot!
Goku gives off a chuckle, interested to see what his brother is made of. Raditz steps up, and if the two brothers teamed up, they're actually pretty confident that taking out Cell will be a piece of cake. And throw Gohan and Trunks into the mix, and Cell is pretty much screwed. They'll do that if absolutely necessary, but before that, they might as well have some fun fighting the android. Cell is pretty interested in Raditz. He does obviously know who Raditz is now, but he doesn't actually have Raditz's DNA in him. You see, I like to keep Trunks' timeline the same in my scenarios, and I do the same for Cell. He is the original Cell that we saw in Dragon Ball, so he has the DNA of people like Goku, Vegeta, Frieza, Piccolo, etc. And since Cell never had Raditz's DNA in the original story, he doesn't here either. Or at least, he was never confirmed to. Since he never stated it himself or showed off anything about it, and since Raditz was pretty weak for a sample anyways, yeah, it's safe to assume that Cell doesn't have Raditz's DNA in him. This is good for Raditz, because he actually doesn't know Raditz's moveset too well. The fight here is actually very close, but Cell is still advantage in power. Eventually, Cell gets very invested in the fight, and blows up the arena to fight Raditz without limitations. The fight rages on, and Raditz is able to keep up, but Cell keeps regenerating. However, he is running out of stamina. Raditz is impressed with Cell, and now he taps Goku into fight, curious to see what Kakarot can do. Cell is getting a little bit angry, and he was pleased with fighting Raditz, but now he's just forfeiting, and he's not getting anywhere. Are these Saiyans actually this strong? Yes, they are. Cell is facing Goku now, and this fight is also pretty close. Goku's at full stamina, and never gives Cell a Senzu Beam, so he's kind of advantage here, but Cell can still regenerate. Goku also has no instant transmission in this scenario, and unlike Raditz, Cell is actually aware of Goku's fighting style and moveset. This actually closes the gap somewhat, but Cell is getting more and more aggressive. He's pissed off that Goku's treating this like a game, and so was everyone else. Running out of stamina, he's fighting more violently, and he's starting to pick up the pace. Goku decides that he's had enough, and he thanks Cell for the fight. Hey Gohan, why don't you jump in next?
Wait, are you forfeiting too?
Well, yeah. I am just following your rules after all.
Are you mocking me? You bastard!
Angered by the patronizing he's receiving, Cell decides to cut to the chase and just do what he was made to do anyways, that being his objective. Kill Goku. Goku's smile then drops when he senses Cell's power behind him, and he turns back to see an enraged Cell. Not even expecting it, out of nowhere, a perfect death beam pierces through Goku's chest, flying through to a nearby mountain and exploding on impact. Goku falls out of Super Saiyan and falls to the ground. Cell, panting out of exhaustion, lets out a chuckle as everyone just watches in horror, including Mr. Satan and the whole camera crew, as well as everyone watching worldwide. Chi-Chi yells out for Goku, with Raditz grabbing a senzu bean from Krillin, who's paralyzed with fear. He rushes over to his brother, with Gohan beside him. Raditz picks up Goku, and then it hits him. Kakarot has died. Raditz looks up towards Cell with his teeth gritted as his power begins to rise, with Gohan trying to revive Goku somehow, as Cell just gives a smug laugh. Cell's grin turns to a frown though. Next to Raditz, Gohan begins crying, but also screaming in anger. After an explosion of ki, Gohan's aura, demeanor, and even his hair completely changed. He has ascended to Super Saiyan 2. Almost in unison, Raditz experiences something similar. While he never expected to have any sort of bond with Kakarot ever in his life, that has greatly changed over the past few years. Despite once being separated and not even knowing each other really, Kakarot now has always been there for Raditz, even giving him a second chance when no one else accepted him, and was basically an outcast on Earth. Out of rage for his brother's death, Raditz also powers up. Cell is completely terrified now. Standing before him is not just Gohan, but Raditz, both using some previously unknown power, called Super Saiyan 2. Raditz taps into it through immense rage, while Gohan does the same through immense sadness. The two blitz Cell together. Even one of these guys would be too much for Cell to block attacks from, but now he's facing two of them. It's nearly impossible for him to even counter anything. Tossed between the two of them, Raditz and Gohan beat Cell back and forth. Cell tries to regenerate, but as soon as he does, he's hit again and again. Badly beaten and broken, he can't really do anything. With one powerful kick to the torso, Raditz launches him up in the air. Charging purple energy in his hand, he launches a vacation delete, while Gohan fires a Kamehameha. The two attacks combine, I guess into a vacation delete Kamehameha, not really the most catchy name, but the swirling blue and purple energy blast makes contact with Cell, and turns the android into nothingness. After the brutal battle, Cell is finally dead, gone from existence. Raditz and Gohan power back down into their base forms, and take a moment to calm themselves, and go back over to where they were. Near Goku's body, everyone is gathered around, with Chi-Chi being understandably distraught over it, as well as Krillin to some extent. Piccolo chimes in though, not trying to ruin the moment, but reminding everyone, Goku's gonna be fine. He and Kami never merged, so the Dragon Balls are still on Earth. Plus, in this scenario, Goku hasn't died. They can bring him back to life with the Dragon Balls, with no issues. I mean, in the moment, everyone basically forgot that when overcome with emotions, and only now is beginning to realize it. They decide right away that they need to hunt for the Dragon Balls ASAP, so they head to the lookout with Goku's body, and then go to actually search. At the arena, or what's left of it, Mr. Satan is completely speechless. His cameras, understandably, had cut once Goku died. I mean, you can't really show that on live TV. They ask Mr. Satan if he has anything to say about it, and, well, he says Goku's gonna be A-okay. He thinks. And Cell is no longer an issue. He killed that Bugman with no problem. The champion always wins, baby. Like usual, Mr. Satan is hailed as the hero. After a quick journey gathering the Dragon Balls, all of them are brought to the lookout, and Shenron is summoned. A single wish is made. Revive everyone killed by the actions of Cell. The few humans that have been absorbed by him in the past, as well as the androids killed from him dying, and Goku, are all brought back. Goku wakes up and looks around, seeing everyone around him. Glad to have been brought back so quickly. Everyone now celebrates with the defeat of Cell. But remember what I just mentioned. The wish was made to bring back everyone that was killed by Cell's actions, and that did include the androids. Not Android 16, because he's not a human, but 17 and 18, that means they're going to be brought back to life. During a celebration for the victory, two unexpected party guests show up. Of course, I am referring to 17 and 18. Understandably, knowing that these are the same androids that wanted to kill Goku, everyone gets into a fighting stance, ready to take them on. But they're not actually here for that. They're mainly here to extend some sort of neutrality towards them. After being revived, they kinda assume that what happened is that Cell died and then that everyone is brought back. And they pretty much know firsthand how strong Cell is, considering that they couldn't take him on themselves. And if some of the members of the Dragon Team killed Cell, well, they kinda realize that they're not gonna have any chance of killing Goku. But this whole process has made them realize something. It's kinda pointless for them to go after Goku in the first place. I mean, really, it's not them wanting to do it, Jiro just programmed them to do it. And they assure that they're not here for a fight, but really more so just to save their asses. They know for a fact that they wouldn't be able to face Goku or his friends anyways. And I mean, they're right. If they even tried, they'd be obliterated by just one of them. And they really just more so care about their lives right now, and don't want to really deal with all that kill Goku nonsense. And to be fair, Goku already did technically die, so isn't their objective accomplished already? Well, not by them, but Cell. So even if they did want to kill Goku, I mean, mission complete, kinda? I don't know, they just want to be out of this whole business anyways. It's kinda unexpected that they showed up, but just as quickly as they appeared, they disappear. They're still pretty young and would rather just focus on their normal lives, rather than their android lives. So maybe now they'll just go off and do whatever life has for them. Following this, Trunks ends up heading back to his timeline, thanking everyone for the help. While the androids here might be neutral, not really good, but they're not gonna attack anyone at least, the androids in his timeline definitely are still bad. Thankfully, he's more than strong enough to actually take them on himself now. And although it's kinda odd for him to find out about Raditz being his father in this timeline, he's sorta grown accepting of Raditz. I mean, he doesn't really view Raditz as a father or anything, because really Raditz isn't his father. But he's come to terms with the fact that this timeline's different, and he accepts it now. And they're at least a lot more friendly than they were before. And besides that, he's glad that he was able to help this timeline, as well as see someone like Gohan again, albeit as a kid rather than an adult. Trunks steps back into his time machine and heads back to his timeline. Soon after he arrives back, he's able to encounter the androids again, and this fight goes pretty quickly, and it's one-sided. He's able to take them out with really no issue at all, meaning that after all this time and all the suffering in his life, his timeline is finally safe. Well, there's still one more threat that he needs to face, and that's one that hasn't appeared yet but will appear soon, Cell. But it's not really fair to call it a threat. In terms of power, imperfect Cell's not really going to be anything compared to Trunks when she actually shows up. And like clockwork, Cell does end up showing up, but it's not really that much of a challenge for Trunks. He dispatches of the bio-android fairly easily, and just like that, his timeline is completely free of the android menaces, and he's finally proclaimed victory. And back in the present timeline, of course, all is going pretty well, and from here, we can actually get into the 7-year time skip. But we're gonna save that and all the Buu Saga stuff for the next episode. About 7 years have passed since the Cell games, and now we're gonna arrive into the Buu Saga. Over this course of time, everyone does actually keep up training. First of all, Goku and Raditz will obviously keep up with theirs. And as Goten grows older, Chi-Chi is able to keep up with her training too, as well as bringing Goten along once he's old enough. As for Gohan, well, he still has a dream of being a scholar, and Chi-Chi does want her kids to study, but she's more open to letting them train this time around. There's no reason for them not to. She actually kinda encourages it because it's some nice father-son bonding with Goku, as well as bonding with Raditz. So Gohan actually keeps up with his training this time, and he remains as the strongest fighter, with Raditz pretty close behind and Goku catching up once he unlocks Super Saiyan 2 for himself. In the last part, a lot of you suggested that Chi-Chi should get Kaioken, and over the 7 years I can honestly see that happening. If Krillin keeps training with everyone, then maybe he'd end up teaching Kaioken to Chi-Chi as well. The humans don't have those fancy Super Saiyan forms, so Krillin decides to teach Kaioken to anyone who wants to know it. Goku, Gohan, and Raditz don't see any point in learning it because they already have Super Saiyan, which is better than that, so really, Krillin only has to teach it to Chi-Chi and Tien. Yamcha's also kinda slacking on his fighting like normal, so he doesn't really care too much to learn this, but Tien sees it as a pretty useful thing, and both he and Chi-Chi are interested in learning this technique from Krillin. Krillin isn't as good of a teacher of this technique as King Kai is, so it does take a little bit of time, but they are eventually able to access Kaioken, being able to max it out around about Kaioken times 10. Krillin remains as strong as human because he could push Kaioken to higher levels, but Chi-Chi is stronger in base, and by a pretty decent margin, so she's catching up. And in the Saiyaman saga, everything goes pretty much like normal. Gohan goes to high school, meets Videl, becomes the Great Saiyaman, all that stuff. And then we arrive to the tournament. So the tournament itself is also not really that different. In terms of fighters, Mighty Mask and Vegeta are replaced with Raditz and Chi-Chi. And yes, Android 18 is still there. After their brief meeting with the androids, Krillin was actually kind of interested in getting to know 18. He didn't fall in love with her instantly like normal, but they eventually do end up getting together, even if they are at an earlier stage in their relationship at this point in time, but that doesn't really matter too much. Just wanted to point out that she's still here. And as for the tournament itself, well, not much really changes. Everything up until the point that Spopovich is against Videl goes pretty much the same. Up against Kibito, Gohan shows off more power than he does normally, which means Spopovich and Yamu are able to get a lot more than they bargained for. They immediately go and bring it back to Babidi, with the whole group following along, including Chi-Chi and Raditz. After a little bit of flying, everyone arrives at where Babidi's ship is, and they witness Spopovich and Yamu get blown up. Babidi is pleased with the energy they brought, and then Babidi commands Deborah to deal with those pesky intruders, because they realize that other people are watching. Deborah obliges and then immediately goes to attack everyone. Out of nowhere, he appears in front of the group, and launches a full power attack at Raditz, attempting to kill him. In the nick of time, Raditz was able to turn into Super Saiyan 2 and block the attack,
so he's actually kinda injured, but he's overall pretty okay. Deborah is pretty shocked that this didn't kill him, and then decides to use one of his best techniques, which is spitting. Looking around, he sets his sights on two people, Piccolo and Chi-Chi. Before Shin can even warn anyone, he spits immediately towards these two, as they begin turning into stone. Raditz watches angrily, not really being able to do anything due to his injuries, while Goku and Gohan watch terrified as they turn into stone. Goku seeing his wife turn into stone and Gohan seeing his mother turn into stone, as well as their friend Piccolo, yeah, that's not really gonna sit well with them. Almost instantly and out of pure anger, Gohan and Goku instantly go Super Saiyan 2 together, and blitz Deborah. Okay, one of them alone would be overkill for Deborah, but now that you have two of them, it's safe to say that it doesn't go too well. Seconds after, Deborah is dead. Thankfully though, this burst of rage actually saved Chi-Chi and Piccolo, since killing Deborah means they're freed from their stone. So that actually all worked out. Well, for them it worked out, not Babidi. Babidi's been watching from his ship and he's pretty scared right now. Checking the energy he got from Spopovich and Yamu, it's a decent amount, about 60 or 70%. But these guys killed Deborah instantly, and he doesn't really have any other strong fighters besides Yakan and Pui Pui, who are nowhere near the strength of Deborah, and if they were able to kill Deborah that quickly, then he's not going to be able to get enough energy. Not only that, but he's not going to be able to defend himself against them. So what can he do? Well, he always does have the option of trying to possess someone. It's just a matter of actually finding someone in the group to possess, but is there anyone that he can? He searches through their minds, and there's two of them that seem like potential candidates. Of course, Raditz would be one of the candidates, but that's not going to happen for Babidi. Unlike Vegeta, who willingly would have let himself get possessed, Raditz wouldn't really do the same, because he has no desire to fight Goku. Not only because Goku's been alive this entire time, but because he's not like Vegeta where he'd want to fight all out with Goku. And he has no ill will towards his brother, they've actually grown pretty close. And besides that same reasoning that made Vegeta turn Majin, there's really no reason for Raditz to turn over to that side. He's been fully reformed and is accustomed to his Earth life now, so he's not gonna become bad again. Piccolo would be the other option, but no shot. Babidi actually does try to possess him, but that's not gonna work. Piccolo also doesn't have any reason to turn bad, and with his mental fortitude, he basically kicks Babidi out of his head. It's actually kind of funny for the group because both Raditz and Piccolo have the same experience, and that means they realize that Babidi is pretty much out of options because he's trying to possess people now. They've basically already won, they just gotta go on the ship and clean up. And they do that, it's not too hard. There's Yakan and Pui Pui obviously, but they're easily dealt with. And Babidi uses all the magic abilities he can to try and delay everyone, but they eventually do get to him. He's just delaying the inevitable. So yeah, that's pretty much the end of the Buu saga. Buu's never awoken, and the only people that died were the Majins. So it's a very successful endeavor. And that means we can continue on to Dragon Ball Super. And it's not really too different, at least in Battle of Gods. Beerus wakes up after having his dream about the Super Saiyan God, and then everyone on Earth receives a warning from Shin and Kabito knowing about Beerus' awakening. They tell them who he is and why they should be wary, and especially they tell Goku to not try and fight him, just basically listen to whatever he says and don't get in his way. And Beerus does end up getting there with Whis, during Bulma's birthday party. And like I said, there's not really much reason for any of this to go different. The real difference is that Beerus doesn't get angered because there's no Buu there, so there's no pudding situation. But that's not going to deter him from wanting to see a Super Saiyan God. And after summoning Shenron and asking a brief question, he gets just that. Because they figure out how to do the ritual, and they decide to perform it on Goku. It doesn't work at first, and then they realize that they need an extra Saiyan. To which both Bulma and Videl step up. Huh, weird timing. They're both expecting kids now. And that means that there's a half Saiyan in them, and that probably would be worth a shot to try. So they try it out, and it does end up working. Goku gets Super Saiyan God, and there's not much else that changes. Really, the biggest takeaway here is that Bulma is going to be born a bit earlier, but besides that, there's nothing really too special about Battle of Gods here. The changes in the story so far wouldn't really affect it too much. It's the stuff that follows which is actually going to change more. Beerus is pretty impressed with Goku and offers him a place to train on his planet. Naturally being interested, Raditz asks if he can join as well, and Beerus and Whis don't see why not. Hell, it's probably better if they had two Saiyan training with them rather than one. That just means two strong rivals for Lord Beerus. So they go off to train, and then some time passes. Everything on Earth is relatively peaceful, until one day, where the sky turns black. Someone is using the Dragon Balls. And that someone, well, it's not someone, it's a group. It's the Frieza Force that came to Earth, and they try to get the Dragon Balls for themselves, which they successfully ended up doing. Their main wish here, naturally, is to revive Lord Frieza. And although he's brought back in pieces, their wish is granted. And now they just have to deal with putting him back together somehow. I mean, you can't really be an effective emperor if you're just gonna be a bunch of steak tips. They need him to be whole again. He's placed in a rejuvenation chamber and he makes a full recovery. But before heading to Earth, he decides he's gonna do some training, something that he never thought he would do. It's such a nasty thing to do, but he decides it's worth a shot to train. 4 months of rigorous training actually lets him grow a lot stronger, as well as unlock a new form which he refers to as Golden Frieza, choosing the color gold just so everyone knew how powerful he was. Needless to say, he feels pretty confident and proud of himself. All that hard work actually paid off, and now he's insanely powerful. Now it's time to actually put this power to the test, so he's gonna head to Earth and try and use it. The Frieza Force arrives to Earth, and they're actually greeted with some company. Just like in Resurrection F, that same group of people is there waiting for them. Gohan, Piccolo, Roshi, Tien, Krillin, and Jaco, as well as Chi-Chi this time. Not only does the Dragon Team have one extra member here, but they're a lot stronger too, collectively. Pretty much everyone here besides Roshi probably has had some dramatic increase in power over the past few years. Or really this whole what if in general. Not that it matters anyway, because the Frieza Force soldiers aren't really that big of a threat. They deal with the entire army relatively quickly, basically wiping out Frieza's entire army. It's impressive to Frieza that they're able to defeat his whole army, but that's not really gonna cut it. They are nothing compared to him. And he is a little pissed off that Goku and Raditz aren't here, but those other two that oppose them, Gohan and Piccolo, are here, so, I mean, at least two of the four people are here that he wants to get revenge on. He's pretty confident that he could take those two on, even in his first form alone. And this overconfidence is gonna come and bite him in the ass. Gohan can immediately sense how much stronger Frieza has gotten in his first form alone, which means his other forms must have gotten an exponential increase in power. And it also seems to him like Frieza's hiding something, like he has some sort of ace up his sleeve that no one knows about. They would need to wait for Goku and Raditz to arrive on Earth if Frieza were to transform. But there's actually a chance that they could stop Frieza before he even transforms. Gohan alone in Super Saiyan 2 is probably more than enough to take on first form Frieza, as long as he could defeat him before he transforms. Frieza's pretty cocky right now and confident that he could win, so it's a good opportunity to take advantage of him. During one of Frieza's monologues, Gohan suddenly powers up into Super Saiyan 2 going all out, and immediately attacks Frieza. Frieza receives a punch to the gut that knocks the wind out of him, and then with a full power Masenko, Gohan delivers a blast to Frieza that completely incinerates him. Gohan was right to act as quickly as he did, because little did they know, Frieza had a new form up his sleeve that would have destroyed everyone. Well, unless Goku and Raditz were to show up. It's a good thing he's kept up with his training, because he was able to go Super Saiyan 2 still, and he was strong enough to take on first form Frieza, which inadvertently prevented a global threat. This only serves as more motivation for him to keep going. And even if he's not going to be on the level of his father or even Raditz now that he's training with Beerus, it's still good to know that he's strong enough to defend Earth. Goku and Raditz eventually get word of this from Whis, and they're glad that Earth was able to handle it on its own, and they don't need to intervene. So they can continue with their training while Earth lives in peace, knowing that it has defenders. Their training's actually been going pretty well so far. They've gotten exponentially stronger, and are even tapping into some new powers they didn't even know existed. It's all going very smoothly, and they're seeing some great gains. However, one day, Beerus's planet gets an unexpected visitor. It looks like a fat Beerus, and then a female Whis. It turns out this is Champa and Vados, Beerus's brother and Whis's sister, the god and angel of Universe 6, the twin universe of Universe 7. Champa's been snooping around this universe to try and gather the Super Dragon Balls, and Beerus isn't really happy about it. Like the two brothers usually do, they have a major disagreement and decide why not settle it with a fight between all of their universe's strongest fighters, the Tournament of Destroyers. They both agree and the date is set, and that's where we'll leave off for now. So of course, the natural thing to do after Resurrection F is go into the Universe 6 tournament. Champa would show up in Universe 7, looking for the Dragon Balls, and eventually that would spark the rivalry between him and Beerus again. And they'll have the idea for a tournament. So who's gonna join the team here? Well, it's pretty obvious that Goku and Raditz are gonna be on there, and there's some other really good choices for the team. However, I feel that they would most likely settle for other people in the Sun family. Their first option would probably be Gohan, and then followed by that, Chi-Chi might end up wanting to join, as well as Goten. Pretty simple, we have a full team now. And that means we could head off into the tournament. We have a pretty solid lineup for Universe 7. And first up, we have Goten versus Batamo. Goten has been training here, but the thing is, Batamo's ability is a little bit hard for him to overcome. However, I'm sure he'd be able to work around it. We've seen Goku, Gohan, and even Vegeta all do the same thing, either in this arc or in the Tournament of Power. His ability is kind of a double-edged sword, so maybe his elasticity will be used against him. Or Goten could just tie him up or something. But I'll say Goten takes the win here, and next he's up against Frost. And Frost wins because he has the poison needles, cheating like usual. Chi-Chi's up against him next, and they find out that Frost has the poison needles. He gets disqualified, and this means Goten can get back in the tournament, but his place starts at the end. And of course, Chi-Chi stays in as well because Frost was cheating. Needless to say, Champa's pretty pissed off at him. Chi-Chi is up against Magetta next, and of course, she's not able to hurt him, pretty much like everyone else. She does eventually learn of the Metal Man's weakness though, insults. Knowing Chi-Chi's temper, I'm sure she'll be able to come up with some pretty creative insults against him, creating an easy win for her. She's up against Kaba next, and Kaba takes the win here, because even in his base form I feel like he would overpower her. It is a very respectable match though, and then Raditz is up against him next. However, Raditz is heavily holding back, and once he goes Super Saiyan he learns that Kaba's never seen this form before. Well, he's pretty much got this battle in the bag, so instead of trying to draw it out against Kaba, he decides why not have some fun and teach this kid the Super Saiyan form. So kind of like Vegeta, they start to develop somewhat of a master-student bond, and although he isn't as brutal as Vegeta in teaching the technique, I'm sure with his extensive knowledge of Super Saiyan, and his general intelligence, Raditz will probably come up with a way to teach Kaba this form. Kaba learns it and he's grateful for it, but of course Raditz still takes the win like normal. And finally, Raditz is up against Hit. This should be interesting. Maybe Raditz will get to test out his new form that he and Kakarot got. Not Super Saiyan God, but no, he's gonna have to dial it up to Super Saiyan Blue. But this still doesn't do anything against Hit. Hit takes the win against Raditz, and next, Goku's up against him. So how strong is Goku here? Well, I'd place him around where he is in canon. And that does sound like a good thing, but you gotta remember here. He doesn't have Kaioken, which means no Super Saiyan Blue Kaioken. He could put up a good fight against Hit all he wants, but in the end, he'll probably end up taking a loss here. No Kaioken means he can't actually get a win against Hit, or at least get Hit to forfeit in the next round. And the next round is Gohan versus Hit. Needless to say, Hit takes the win.
From his brief battle with Raditz, Hit was able to progress a bit, but even more so against Goku. He's like an unstoppable force. Gohan would fight him next, but the result would be similar.
Things aren't looking good because finally, it's Hit versus Goten. Of course, Goten's pretty nervous. And he powers all the way up to Super Saiyan 2, trying to get some kicks and punches in on Hit, but it does nothing. Trying to be gentle, with just one finger, Hit knocks Goten out. Universe 6 takes the win. Alright, this is kind of a friendly tournament, so this doesn't seem too bad, right? Well, the consequences of losing this tournament means that Earth would be sent to Universe 6, which obviously is a pretty huge deal. Beerus is pissed, needless to say, and Champa's pretty content, but there's not really anything Beerus could do about it. He did agree to this after all, and he knew the stakes. Zeno does visit the tournament though, and is pretty interested in what's going on. He might try something like this himself in the future. He forms somewhat of a friendship with Goku here too, but he ends up taking his leave. Champa, as the victor, gets his wish on the Super Dragon Balls. And he wasn't kidding. Earth gets teleported to Universe 6. And now, I kinda gotta cover two arcs briefly. One being the future Trunks arc, and then one being the arc in Universe 6 where everyone's just getting adjusted. So first, let's go with future Trunks. Like normal, Zamasu ends up stealing Goku's body. Maybe he could even steal Raditz's body here, but it doesn't really matter. It'll probably still end up being Goku Black. He goes to Trunks' timeline, and he causes havoc. Trunks sees no other option but to travel back in time once again. And here's where it gets a little bit tricky. There's two things that could happen here, both pretty bad. One, Trunks isn't able to return to the past because there is no Earth to return to, so he's stuck in the future, and he gets killed by Zamasu. Or two, which is really morbid, Trunks teleports to the past and there's no Earth there, which means his time machine is just floating in the vacuum of space. He either runs out of oxygen, or the time machine opens and he gets sucked into space and dies. So, I'm sorry to say, but Trunks is dead here, and his whole timeline's pretty much screwed. Zamasu gets the dub here, and so does Goku Black. The Zero Mortals plan proceeds like normal. Keep this in mind though, this isn't the end of it and we're gonna get back to this later on in the video. In the meantime though, completely oblivious to Trunks' struggle, Earth is now getting adjusted to Universe 6. I mean, there's not really anything to get adjusted to. People on Earth probably panic because they realize they're not in the same solar system anymore, but overall everyone's pretty much fine. It would be really weird because the days would probably change and the years and whatnot, but overall Earth would survive and pretty much continue like normal. As for our heroes, well, there's a few things that change here. Raditz did make a promise to Kaba to visit planet Sadala someday, and now that they're in Universe 6, why not? They have spaceships, and they could probably find the planet pretty easily. The thing is here, Goku and Raditz don't have the same relationship with Champa as they do with Beerus, so I don't know if they'd necessarily be training with him. He doesn't even seem like that kind of guy. I mean, if he was smart, he would've trained up Kaba and gotten him a god form. You know, that might be an interesting video topic that I'll cover in the future, but besides that, Raditz decides why not have a family trip to planet Sadala. Well, even with Earth being teleported to a different universe and all, everyone's lives are still going somewhat normal, so people like Gohan and Goten have responsibilities and can't come along, but Raditz does end up going with his brother. They are able to meet up with Kaba, and Raditz is glad to see him again. He wishes he could have brought Trunks to introduce him, but this is fine too, considering they're all allied now and Raditz really has nothing else going on, especially since he's not going to be training with Champa. He and Goku start training with Kaba, and they're pretty amazed with how quickly Kaba learns stuff. It must be something that the Universe 6 Saiyans can do easily. In their training eventually, they do go around the planet and end up meeting two other people. One is a leader of some Saiyan gang named Caulifla, and another female Saiyan named Kale. They eventually catch wind of this because they realize that there's two new Saiyans on the planet, and Kaba has something called Super Saiyan now, which they've never actually seen before. And of course, they want to get that for themselves. Well, at least Caulifla does. It's a little bit weird and she kind of forces herself into the training, but she asks everyone if they could teach her that same technique. Another student is probably going to be really fun for Goku and Raditz to teach, so why not? Kale is nervous to train, but then she sees how Caulifla is getting along with everyone so well, and she ends up going berserk. Understandably, Kaba's pretty terrified and Caulifla's amazed, while Goku and Raditz are just concerned and confused. They've never seen anything like this before and she's completely lost control. They wonder what this form actually is and how she's able to do it. Thankfully, they're able to calm Kale down, and it looks like they have a new task at hand. Like I mentioned, they don't really have anything going on and they would have been on Beerus' planet anyways in Universe 7, so for now they're going to actually just stay here and train with everyone. Visiting a planet full of Saiyans and learning about it is actually pretty fun for Goku, and for Raditz too because he didn't really know it too well as a kid, given the fact that he was very young when Vegeta was blown up. It's a pretty fun experience. The Saiyans here are pretty similar to Universe 7's, but still somewhat different. Eventually, about a year passes, and Zeno is pretty bored. He doesn't even have future Zeno here with him, so he doesn't really have anything going on. But then he remembers, he had that tournament planned before. Maybe he should go see his friend Goku and see what that's all about. Unexpectedly, one day on Sadala, Champa shows up with Vados, and Champa's pretty terrified. He finds Goku and tells him that Zeno has summoned him and wants to see him, and tells him not to say anything stupid. He and Vados take him to Zeno's palace, where they meet up with Zeno and then hear about this idea for a tournament. Something like the Tournament of Destroyers, but between all of the universes instead of just those two. They have to get a group of 10 fighters, and they're all gonna fight in a battle royale, with the losers being erased. Goku and Champa are obviously pretty scared from this. But on the bright side, whoever wins gets the Super Dragon Balls for a wish, but there's still the huge stakes behind that. Well, crap. On the way back, Champa and Goku try to come up with some members for their team. Champa's gonna contact Hit and have him be the leader of the team, and Goku's gonna be tasked with recruiting people from either Earth or Sadala, or any other planets that exist here. So who's Goku gonna actually pick? Well, obviously Raditz is gonna be there, same for Caulifla, Kale, and Kaba. The training for everyone has gone pretty well, and they've actually unlocked Super Saiyan 2, all of them. Kale has even learned to control her rage and kinda has her own form of Super Saiyan 2, just like we saw normally, except she has it much earlier this time around. So that's a pretty good start. They have 5 members, and then of course they have Hit, which makes 6. Alright, well, what now? Goku and Raditz head to Earth and decide they're gonna recruit some people there. Gohan's an obvious pick, and of course Chi-Chi's pretty eager to join too. Given the stakes and how they already have enough team members, they decide they're not going to actually recruit Goten and Trunks here. Instead, they recruit the next strongest people, that being Piccolo and Krillin. Both have been keeping up with their training, and of course Krillin's pretty strong here with Kaioken and all. And eventually, their group meets up with Hit, who is the leader after all, and decided to come to Earth to see if he could recruit anyone. The thing is, including Goku, there already are 9 other members. Besides Hit, of course, so that makes 10. Hit actually went out to Namek and recruited 2 people, Sanel and Perina, who actually merge with their entire planet like normal. It sounds pretty risky to do that, but given the universe is at stake and all, it's actually kind of a good strategy. Okay, so now I guess they gotta kick 2 people off the team to make space for the Namekians, so they have to try and decide something. However, the Namekians point something out. Piccolo on the team is a Namekian as well, and he's actually pretty strong, even though he hasn't fused with anyone in this scenario. Remember, the Namek Saga was completely different here, and he never fused with Nail. The Cell Saga was pretty different too, and he never fused with Kami either. So hearing about Namekian fusion is actually big news to him. Knowing how strong Piccolo is on his own, although he's not near the level of them, Sanel and Pirina think that he might actually be a good candidate for someone to fuse into. Piccolo's obviously taken aback by this, since this is his first time hearing about Namekian fusion when being introduced to them. And he's pretty wary of it because he kinda wants to keep his own identity. They promise him it's all fine, they're just gonna be merging their power and they'll live on within him without affecting his personality. They need to do everything they can to protect the universe, and they're even willing to merge with this complete stranger just to do that. He is a fellow Namekian after all, and he could make for a great host body. Hit agrees with this as well, as they won't have to replace anyone on the team, and they'll have a much stronger fighter. Once again, given the stakes, that's gonna change how people act in situations like this. And he's hesitant, but Piccolo eventually accepts. Sanel and Pirina fuse into him, creating one massively powerful Namekian. He looks like Piccolo, sounds like Piccolo, and acts like Piccolo, but his power is something out of this world. All the Namekians from Universe 6 are now merged into Piccolo, And with this huge boost in power, everyone's amazed to see how strong he is. Given the fact that Goku and Raditz didn't get the same training here because they weren't with Beerus or Champa, nor did they have the experience of the future Trunks arc, they're not comparable to Goku and Vegeta in the main story, not at all. And because of that, I'd actually place Piccolo above them in terms of power. Hit is still the strongest on the team, but Piccolo is second. This huge fusion actually brings him great power, and everyone's confident that they'll be able to do well in the tournament. Time passes and the time is here. They go to the World of Void and the tournament begins. Obviously, they're interested in seeing what Universe 7 has for a team, and understandably, Beerus doesn't really have anything for his team. He does have a few weird picks on there though. When hearing about this tournament, he had Whis take him all around the universe to see what they could find. Their first choice is kind of a weird one, and it's Jocko, who's actually the leader of Universe 7. And of course with him, they have the help of the Galactic Patrol trying to find people. Without Earth, they don't really have too many. They're pretty short on options, but I did come up with a team for them. Another team member is a Namekian Fusion, kind of like the Namekian Savior we saw in the Moro arc, and also kind of similar to what Piccolo is right now. We'll just refer to him as the Namekian Savior we saw from the Moro arc. And their scouting actually paid off because they did end up finding a really strong candidate. This team's gonna get pretty crazy because now we're gonna introduce Broly, a real wildcard pick that they were lucky to find. It's weird to know that there's another Saiyan actually existing in Universe 7. Goku and Raditz didn't even know about this. Who is this guy? But that's only three people, they need some more. The issue is there's not really many strong people left in Universe 7, besides some people that are locked up in the Galactic Patrol prison. It's a really bad idea, but Beerus, against his better judgment, decides that they might have to free some prisoners. That's their only option. They could probably trust them here, right? I mean, the universe is at stake, so they'll probably cooperate with their team. So who do they actually get? Well, they get 7-3, who's a pretty valuable asset, and they get Sagenbo and his crew. Let's just throw in four other members. So that's 9 people. Who's the 10th member? It's another Galactic Patrol prisoner. And right now, he's not actually the strongest member on their team, but that will change. Someone with a key that terrifies everyone. Someone named Moro. Yep, this team's pretty crazy. There's not really any other options in Universe 7 right now, because really the only strong people in Universe 7 are gods, so they can't join. But at least they have a team, right? As for Universe 6, their team is obviously pretty stacked, and most of the other universes don't stand a chance. Well, besides Universe 11, and unknowingly, Universe 7. The tournament is pretty much a slaughter fest, with Universe 6, Universe 11, and Universe 3 at the top. Universe 7's numbers dwindle pretty quickly, and eventually they're only left with 7-3, Broly, and Moro. Pretty strange crew. And this is where all hell begins to break loose. Over the course of the tournament, people begin powering up and notice that they're actually somewhat weaker than normal, almost as if they're losing energy whenever they decide to transform. Goku and Raditz notice this when going blue, as do the other Saiyans from Universe 6. Even other members like Topo and Dispo notice this too. Eventually, they're able to figure out that Moro's actually the one behind this. That's when Universe 6 and 11 starts to notice this guy and how strong he is and how much of a formidable opponent he is. He's been sitting back this whole time, but now he reveals his power. Well, actually, he's been using his power this entire time. It's just that no one noticed until now. Universe 3 ends up getting knocked out, and 7-3's copy ability only goes so far, and he eventually ends up getting dropped out too. Universe 7 ends up losing Kaba, Chi-Chi, Krillin, and even Hit, who attempted to face Jiren, as well as Goku, who attempted the same. The only ones left are Raditz, Piccolo, Gohan, Kale, and Caulifla. Universe 11 only has Jiren and Topo left. Things start to get more interesting here. With seemingly no other options against Jiren, Caulifla and Kale break out an item that was given to them by Champa, the Patara Urns. They fuse into Kefla, and along with their team, they attempt to take on people like Topo and Broly. Topo is eventually knocked out, but this Broly guy is pretty scary. He seems like Kale on a whole nother level. All the stress and anger he's facing in the tournament eventually caused him to go into his wrathful state, and ever since he's just been getting stronger and stronger. He's been rampaging around, and Universe 6 ends up having to take him out. Okay, things are looking pretty good for Universe 6 so far. They did lose a lot of people, but they have 4 members left, all of them pretty powerful. The only thing is, now they're facing 2 really strong opponents, Jiren and Moro, who's gotten a lot stronger during this tournament. Jiren decides he's gonna take on Moro himself, wanting to defeat this evil. Everyone's really surprised that Beerus chose this guy as a person to be on their team, because he's obviously pretty evil and doesn't seem like someone you'd depend on for a team. Jiren tries facing Moro, but increasingly, he begins feeling like his punches aren't doing anything. He stops holding back and starts to unleash its full power little by little, exactly like Moro wanted. Covertly this entire time, Moro's been taking everyone's energy without them knowing. Little by little, bit by bit, he's been wearing them down and becoming stronger without them even knowing it. Jiren at his full power is actually a good opponent for Moro, but Jiren's much weaker than he normally would be and he notices this. Moro's been taking his power this entire time, and he still is now, except he makes it more obvious. Universe 6 even joins in to try and fight Moro, but they all get drained of their energy as well. Moro keeps getting stronger and stronger and stronger, and eventually no one could keep up. Absorbing all of Universe 6's and Jiren's energy, Moro ends up being the last one remaining and wins the Tournament of Power. So the outcome here is pretty sad, but also pretty obvious. Moro makes a selfish wish, probably something to give himself more power. He asks the Grand Priest to grant the wish, and the Grand Priest turns to Zeno. Zeno immediately races Moro in Universe 7, leaving none of the universes left. Everything is destroyed. I know the scenario got pretty crazy towards the end, but without Earth in Universe 7, things go really bad. There is one winner here though, and that is Zamasu and Goku Black. While everything in that timeline got erased, Zamasu and Goku Black are just chilling in their timeline, having completed the Zero Mortals plan and being pretty satisfied with themselves. Unless Zeno has erased them by now, they've pretty much won and they're content. So they're the real winners in the scenario and probably the only ones that won anything. Pretty depressing, but yeah, that's how this ends up going. Earth being taken away from Universe 7 is disastrous. And we see where this leads us. So that's the end of the scenario.
The original ending had everyone dying. But after what everyone's been through, that's not fair. With all the buildup and everything, ending it off with everyone dying is not only boring, but just sad. It just negates everything that happened before. But originally, I did that because I first thought, there was no way they could beat Moro. It couldn't be possible, but recently I remembered this scenario and I thought, maybe, there would be a way around it. All the universes are erased. Or, are they? Let's rewind a little bit. Consider this my version of Whis's rewind ability. A few minutes back into the past, before the tournament ends. And instead of Hit trying to eliminate Jiren, he's gonna stay in here. Right now the teams are as follows. Universe 6 has Raditz, Piccolo, Gohan, Kefla, Chi-Chi, Kaba, and Krillin. For Universe 7, there's two fighters left, Moro and Broly. And as for Universe 11, they have Jiren, Topo, and Dispo. Moro was already absorbing energy, although it was very covertly.
But as the tournament continued, they easily figured out what was happening.
The remaining few Gods of Destruction are appalled. Why would Beerus recruit this monster? Beerus squirms in his seat. In hindsight, it wasn't really that good of an idea. Those from Universe 6 and Universe 11 notice Moro and decide they need to take him out somehow before he becomes an issue. He's already grown considerably powerful, possibly enough to restore a bit of his youth, but he's still far, far behind from his full power. After thinking, Hit gets an idea, but it may not work. He, Piccolo, and Raditz are the strongest on the team, but Hit has some unique techniques that they don't have. Plus, it's not like Hit is using all of his abilities because he can't kill people here. And that's an issue for him, no killing or he gets disqualified. But Hit was thinking and he has confidence in his team. He's going to break out his assassin techniques against Moro, aiming to kill him, and if he gets disqualified, the rest of his team will carry on. Hit rushes to Moro, interrupting the flow of time. Moro is trapped in a time loop, but he's struggling his way out of it. Hit knows he can't hold him forever, so he takes his chances. As Moro's stuck in place, Hit draws his fist back, and with a fast and powerful blow, he hits Moro's chest, sending a shockwave through it. Moro shouts, as his eyes go blank. Hit just temporarily stopped his heart. Hit then unfreezes Moro, but he keeps his heart frozen. With Moro then collapsing to the ground, Hit kicks him out of the ring. Moro is dead. With Hit having accomplished his mission, per the rules, the Zenos eliminate him, disqualifying him from the tournament. Lucky for him, he doesn't get erased, but he tells the team it's all up to them. Even with Moro defeated though, there's still some issues, particularly Universe 11 and then Broly. The easiest target is Dispo. Kefla faces him and defeats him pretty easily. And as for Topo, Piccolo is his main contender. Now Topo is a pretty big obstacle, and I mean that in terms of size and power. Piccolo's able to do relatively well against him, and Topo contemplates using his God of Destruction mode. Inevitably, for the sake of his universe, he decides to use it. Piccolo is still able to hold his own against him. All the other fighters are either resting or busy with a Broly, so Piccolo decides he wants to do this himself. It is a pretty close match, and the two are impressed with each other's strength. But Piccolo notes, even with Topo's power, he has to be careful. One wrong move and he might accidentally kill Piccolo, or destroy the ring beneath him. Topo cannot go all out against him, and Piccolo knows this and he's careful about it. Summoning the power of all the Namekians inside of him, he launches a massive Masenko, countering Topo's attacks, and knocking him out of the ring. That only leaves Jiren and Broly left. And right now, Kefla and Kaba are facing Broly, but Broly stops them. Right now he's nowhere near their level, but Broly's actually kinda nervous right now. He was pushed into a relatively big situation here. Now is the last member of Universe 7. Kefla and Kaba tell him there's no need to worry. Once they win, they'll just wish all the universes back. But Broly is still very concerned, mainly about Jiren. With how inexperienced he is, he honestly doesn't see himself winning this. But he makes the same promise to them that he would revive the universes. It's not fair that everyone else needs to die.
but with how strong Jiren is, he wants to team up with them. They can knock him out later or whatever, he doesn't care. It's more important that they get over this obstacle first. They could use all the help they can get. And Jiren's interested to see this. That means he can't meditate anymore, so he stands up, ready to face them. They flinch just from him standing up, as he slowly begins powering up. Kefla, being Kefla, decides she wants to attack Jiren first, and immediately goes for him. He casually blocks all her attacks, but he does have to try a bit. Although, he powers up a little bit more and it's no use. With a single blast, he sends her flying out of the ring, faster than anyone can catch her. As he does this, Piccolo and Raditz rush him together, with Broly coming out on the side. He shouts, knocking them all back, as he lunges through taking out Piccolo next. He's already defeated two of the strongest people on the team. Raditz tries again to go after him, kind of fed up by this, but he is defeated too. That leaves Gohan, Kaba, Krillin, and Chi-Chi. Gohan tries his best to defend, but he gets defeated, as do Krillin and Kaba. As Broly tries to stand back up nearby, Chi-Chi is the last fighter standing against Jiren. Jiren says there's no use, but she doesn't care. She's come this far. She activates Kaioken, launching towards Jiren with a punch. This is her absolute full power, but Jiren simply catches her fist and flings her out without any effort. Universe 6 and Champa say goodbye to Beerus, and Beerus is visibly upset, a little sad and angered. Champa, why did he have to steal Earth? He watches as his former students, his allies, and his brother are erased, and nervously turns back to see Broly in the ring. Broly is attempting to face Jiren, but he's nowhere near strong enough yet. He does get progressively angrier and stronger, but Jiren does not play around. He may be able to access his wrathful state, but no Super Saiyan. And that's even if Jiren gives him enough time to power up. He may defeat Broly before he even unlocks Wrathful, knocking out his final opponent. Beerus apologizes to his team, thanking them for their help. He sighs to himself. Why did Champa have to do that? Beerus and Universe 7 are then erased. This time around, Jiren wins, and he's given the wish. Those in the stands look down, with some knowing what he plans to wish for. He's gonna revive his master. Jiren looks up and sees Zeno looking closely, almost as if he expects something from Jiren. Jiren hesitates, about to revive Gichin. He almost makes the wish, but he stops himself. After reading the room around him, he then smirks. He says two simple words. I see. Jiren looks up at Shenron, and asks for one thing. He wants to restore every universe. This comes as a shock to everyone, but it makes sense. Jiren is probably smart enough to tell what Zeno wanted. Plus, this does benefit him. More strong warriors to face in the future. And he is a man of justice after all. He probably would change his mind eventually wanting to revive all the universes after seeing their valiant efforts to fight. He can wish for anything he wants, right? So why not make the most just wish of all, bringing all those universes back to life? It's what a true Pride Trooper would want to accomplish. Seeing those Universe 6 fighters really got him thinking. He doesn't buy their whole friendship thing, but at the end of the day, they're warriors of justice too, wanting to defend their universe. Zeno is pleased, as is the Grand Priest. Shenron grants the wish, restoring every single universe. Universe 7 is brought back, and as soon as it is, Mora was brought back too. But Beerus walks up to him and instantly erases him. No more of that, he caused too much trouble. The prisoners watch in horror, thinking that they're next, but really, they're just sent back to prison, as the other warriors of Universe 7 return home. But Beerus will remember Broly's name. Maybe sometime down the line he'll visit him. As for Universe 6, they realize Jiren won and wish to restore them. Goku wants to find Jiren again someday and fight him, as well as the others in Universe 6. Particularly Raditz, too. And although it still is a weird adjustment to be living here, they've been here long enough and are beginning to get used to it. But after a year, things suddenly change. It's Beerus and Champa's birthday, and the two aren't necessarily on good terms. Beerus does get a nice gift for his brother, though, and Champa still feels sad about everything, but he reveals to Beerus his gift. As a token of his sorrow, he gives Beerus the Super Dragon Balls, as Beerus wishes Earth to be returned to Universe 7. Beerus thanks Champa, and the two brothers are on better terms, as Champa apologizes. The twins hug, with their relationships and their universes restored. Although, Champa tells Beerus he wants all those Namekians back. They're still inside Piccolo. Worldwide, celebrations happen, although no one knows why this happened and why they're back in Universe 7. Goku, Chi-Chi, Raditz, and all the rest know though. They're content, happy that it turned out this way. It's been about a year since the Tournament of Power, but Goku still has the same thing on his mind. Jiren. Raditz is thinking the same thing too. One of these days, there'll be enough to defeat him. He brought them back for a reason after all. As they look forward to their eventual encounter with Jiren again, this is where we'll end off. So what did you guys think about this ending and the scenario? Let me know your thoughts and suggestions in the comments below, and I'll be sure to check them out to see what you guys think. As always, if you liked the video, be sure to drop a like, and let's try to hit that like goal from the beginning of the video. If you haven't already, why not subscribe, as well as hitting the bell icon to get notified about any future videos that I upload on my channel. Thank you all for watching, thanks for supporting this scenario, and I'll see you on my next video.